back, everybody, to the America's Winters Championship. My name is Frode. I'm joined on the desk by Sottl and Cora, two well-established gassers right now in the America's system. Welcome to the desk, everybody. And what a great video to transition to our last match of day number two. What are some of their initial reactions outside of the tears and the clear Bible thumps going on right now?
You've got to love Chestad, right? Like, the level of support. You know, we saw him. We saw him yesterday, you know, a little bit hesitant for his son to really push full-time into this. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you see the full story now. He's saying to him, you know, don't necessarily go all in on this as a career. It's something you can try out. And if it's something you're enthusiastic about, so awesome for him to be so supportive, drive his son all the way down here. Amazing stuff.
Cora?
Yeah, it's great to see that both players actually have that family support. WTY Bill, a father, his little boy, right. so cute, and his wife, so supportive of him. So it's great to see that both of these players have that real strong family support to help them, you know, make it through these tournaments and encourage them to keep playing.
It's two sides of a coin. One father comes into this competition and one son, but one person will be eliminated. It's time to meet our players for the last match of day number two. Let's first meet WTY Bill.
All right. Bill, very popular streamer in the Eastern scene. Not as well known before this tournament on the Western side of things, but starting to make his impact known. Lost the first round in the Master vs. Apprentice style matchup against Al Sky High, but is looking to make a comeback now in the lower bracket.
Yeah, certainly. He's known as a popular streamer. And of course, he's going to go up against the youngster Chess Dude, hailing from USA.
Chess Dude, 17 years old, has been playing chess for over 10 years and is consistently ranked in the top five of his age group. So this guy is no stranger to competitive play. Interesting to see how he translates over from chess into Hearthstone, and clearly he's seen some major success up to this point, and hopefully he can continue it going on in the future.
He's ranked top five in the entire country at his age group. That's an absurd accomplishment at such a young age. Becoming a chess master at age of 12, absolutely stunning amount of results he's able to get, not just in Hearthstone, but in other games as well. And it's really funny because people always contrast Hearthstone with chess, you know, right. putting him on opposite spectrum, but both in the strategy game corner. This guy has complete mastery over these kinds of board games. Really impressive to see how far he's come. But again, this is an elimination match. You lose your first game, it's still okay, you can go through, but you lose your second series, you're going home. So this is where the rubber hits the road.
Yeah, absolutely. And Chess Dude, I think, honestly, despite losing, one of the standout performances of the first round, his rogue play in particular, you know, we've looked at his stats and he is primarily a rogue player.
Yeah.
So his rogue play on day one was phenomenal. Some of the plays that he made, I think, against the Tempo Mage with the huge mirror entity recognizing the secret breakdown, you know, he's obviously a very skilled person in no matter what he tries to do, able to internalize new skills incredibly quickly.
Yeah, I actually had the chance to analyze that same play where he played around those secrets really very well with that Edwin Van Cleef. Just a very skilled player in general, and especially with Rogue, which we only see two of in this tournament. So very interesting that he's picking some more of those more unique classes to use, and clearly exhibiting that he has mastery of not only chess, but of Hearthstone as well.
It's going to be pretty tough to pick only one person, but we're going to ask you to do it again. Hashtag either ChessDude or WTYBill on Twitter and let us know who you're voting for. We'll show that cool bar, the tug of war going back and forth. Although in the end, you know, it's going to require more than just the votes of the people. They have to stay calm and play their decks to the best of the abilities. I'm going to go ahead and toss it out there. Based on the lineups that we have right here, now that we see the bans, which looks like Warrior and Druid ban on either of those sides, which are blacked out, who are we feeling here? Let's go with you, Sottl.
I'm liking Chess Dude. I think he's going to be fully capable to pick up a win with that rogue based on his play yesterday. And the rest of the lineups, I don't think there's too much of an advantage here. I think the bans are smart from both players. But just based on play yesterday, I think Chess Dude was more impressive in defeat than Bill was.
Yeah, I agree, but I also really like Bill's lineup. I like that Druid that he gets to keep. Kind of unfortunate that the Warrior gets banned, but the Druid can always pick up a win. Mage can always pick up a win, and Warlock is also very strong, so it could be either person's game.
Yeah, I'm very opinionated on that Ramp Druid. I've played a pretty good amount. I know I've talked to some other people as well, and Ramp Druid's in this weird, awkward state in this series where it's not necessarily strong against Freeze Mage because it lacks that punch power of the combo. It's not exactly as threatening against Warrior, which goes toe-to-toe much better threat for threat, and even against Rogue, which has sap and really punishes you for playing big creatures. So I'm really scared for Bill's Druid, but who knows? Maybe surprises are in store
for
the series.
I'm hoping we're surprised. I really like that Wall Druid style. Certainly not optimal in a tournament setting, but hopefully he can find a way to get through it with that. You know, some poor draws from the Rogue, but you never want to depend on poor draws for your opponent. You want to come in confident and bring your own optimized list. So definitely Bill could have an uphill battle for a win in this series, but we're going to find out.
Yeah, Sap is a hell of a card when the average minion in your deck costs about 5.5 mana or something.
Or senior higher, so.
All right, well, we're almost underway with our final match of the day, so let's get ready for game number one between these two players, and we're going to get started. I don't know what's going to happen with what the series will begin with, but I do know that there are some big question marks with whether or not Bill's decks can come over that obstacle of Chess Dude's decks. And I do look at some of the unique choices here, that Rogue, that Ramp Druid, and I think more about, like, why? What really inspires them? Why do you think Rogue is such an interesting pick here for this metagame, Zottle?
I mean, Rogue is such a loyalist class, and we've told the story of how much of a loyalist Chess Dude is. He's over, I think 48% was the stat of his total ladder play, rank play games were with Rogue. So Rogue is a class that when you feel that dominant with it yourself, you kind of feel like it's 55% favored in every matchup. So it makes sense that he'd bring it.
It is true. I think Rogues just have some weird relationship like Rogue players do, where they just can't step away from
right.
it. It's more of an addiction than anything else.
They're the most passionate players. I've never seen a player feel passionate about Secret Paladin, you know. Passionate about, like, who's passionate about mid-range Druid? But Rogue players are so certain of their skill. They're so certain of the deck.
It's such a heated affair. You know, we have a player on our team. His name is Hyped. He loves playing Rogue a lot. In fact, he climbed number one and number two Legend simultaneously with two different accounts. And, you know, he was still playing Rogue even during the darkest times. And we sat him down one day and said, Hyped, I think you have a problem. And he thought, you know, he was in trouble.
A Rogue intervention.
He's like, do I have not enough results? Am I not streaming enough? It's like, no, you're playing Rogue way too often.
Anyway, looking at the opening matchup here, we have Renolock going up against that Rogue, that much-discussed Rogue. Preparation in the opening hand, always a good start for the Rogue. Just allows so much potential early tempo, or in this case, he has the option between using it at some point to generate a huge Van Cleef, or just to go for the resource play for that early prep sprint.
It feels like playing on the Van Cleef would be super all-in relative to your hand, because turns four onwards would be super bad.
Yeah. I'm liking the look of the prep sprint into the Azure Drake. Seems like it curves out pretty well, and that sprint going to draw you four cards. You can get into, you know, Violet Teacher, your other very important minions, Earthring Farseers, more things that you can play, and then later on, you can combo that Van Cleef a little bit better. Unfortunately, Bill going to have so many options for removal of that Van Cleef, so you can't just go all in on that this early.
Yeah, the prep Van Cleef line is stronger in the Warlock matchup if you're playing against a Zoo, where honestly going all in that early is usually enough to carry you just for a few turns until your hand becomes active again. But in this situation, this is definitely a game that's going to go fairly long, so the resource boost of the prep sprint next turn is going to be huge.
It's interesting to note, too, that right before this series, I was watching Chalky's series against Talion. And WTY Bill and Chesty were sitting right behind me, and we were all talking about plays. And it feels like they rarely agreed. They actually were split on a lot of opinions, like, oh, do you think he plays the Mal'Ganis here, or do you think he does something else? And both of the, you know, Chess was like, this was okay, and then Bill was like, no, I think you do this. And it just felt like they were disagreeing a lot. So even though it seems like they both might be more of that control style, you know, it's just really interesting how they split opinions on that, especially for a guy like Bill who says he wants to play perfectly every time.
Yeah. And it's a fascinating thing about Hearthstone, honestly, is there's kind of this perception now that we're so far along in Hearthstone that everyone's kind of figured the game out and we're all playing really close to perfectly, but it's just absolutely not the case. And you get that impression whenever you get like a big collection of strong minds together. Everyone disagrees so much. There's so much argument between optimal lines. Yeah. We're nowhere near figuring out what optimal Hearthstone looks like.
Yeah, for sure. And speaking of optimal lines, I just want to touch on this. Bill actually played out that Acidic Swamp Ooze, got rid of Chess Dude's 1-2 dagger, which seems like a really nice play, but seeing that you only have that one Acidic Swamp Ooze in your Reno lock, Sottle, is it better to play that now when you can get some good early value from it, or would you rather save it for later on when Chess Dude is going to be building up those bigger daggers with Deadly Poison and Tinker Sharp Sword Oil?
The important thing here is that it fit the curve nicely, and also you are denying, you know, two mana of tempo from your opponent, essentially. The dagger has come up, hasn't got anything done. You've put down this board, you've established the position. And also, turn four is a turn where Rogue wants to commit a lot of mana. They want to play Violet Teacher, they want to prep sprint, that kind of thing. So that dagger was obviously preloaded with the intention of, you know, having some mana already invested to affect the board, and then that was torn away from him by the Acidic Ooze.
That's a great observation, Zottle. And I think what you really can understand too is that Rogue is also a class that many times won't let you get the optimal removal on the weapon.
Right.
When you use Blade Flurry in a turn, it's like, well, I was gonna ooze that. Don't flurry. And it's like, you know, the Rogue won't let you because they're going for these big swing burst opportunities.
Right.
Yeah, and Bill, instead of choosing to take a really nice Defender of Argus there, or even playing out that Kazan Mystic, not too strong, but a 4-3 is always nice, decides to coin out the Lotheb, effectively shutting down so much of Chess Dude's hand.
Yeah, I love this because you just saw the prep sprint come out from Chess Dude. So the one thing that you know Rogue can do with a handful of cards is pick apart a small board like this. So the Lotheb is going to come down here, cement the board position, allow these minions to continue to be aggressive on the following turn. And he may just be able to push through enough aggression here just to use that as a platform to build an advantage in this game very quickly.
Oh, even holding once again and not killing off the Young Priestess. He wants full value on something like Flurry. And maybe Bill will read into that and not play too much into it. That's a big problem with something like Reno Lock these days. How do you actually end the game when you set up like a Lotheb? It's usually to stay more of alive than to end the game.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I mean, look at Chess Dude's hand. He's got prep, he's got the Tinker's double eviscerate, Blade Flurry. How can you not want to set up that dagger for such an impactful turn?
Yeah, W2 Bill gonna go ahead and just drop the Argus here. Try and protect his board as best he can from what he can probably get a strong read is an incoming high removal turn from his opponent. Mm-hmm. Had that combination of the Lotheb that he played last turn and the weak turn that he saw in response means the hand is stacked with removal. And then holding the dagger makes him suspect the Blade Flurry as well. So he's trying to make his board as awkward as to remove as possible, getting that 6 health Lotheb down.
Yeah. Although there was a potential risky situation where if the buff from the Young Priestess landed on the Lotheb, the removal wouldn't be as clean, and then all of a sudden you'd be in this awkward spot where, like, do I have to attack into that Lotheb?
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't really have the health to play with right now. It's been such an aggressive start, you know, compounded with the tempo ooze that you talked about, Cora, and then the quick Lotheb follow-up to lock the board down. So taking away the Rogue's ability to attack things with their face, with their own hero power, is one of the huge ways you can stop them gaining an advantage. Because in isolation, that dagger hero power is one of the most powerful in the game until you run out of health to use it.
This is clever. I really like the sequencing from Chess Dude. He's playing around the idea of Big Game Hunter. At first, I was thinking, you want to put out a really big Van Cleave. But he's shutting down two possible removal options in favor of loading up this Van Cleave as a reasonable size threat. Now, if that Safe and Sold didn't exist, Bill wouldn't actually have a clean answer to it. So that was a pretty good move, although it doesn't end up paying off here.
Right. Yeah, that play, very difficult to sequence. You can definitely see from Chess Dude's decisions that he's played a lot of Rogue. Some people definitely would have gone for just the largest Van Cleef possible, played Backstab, then played Prep, played the Van Cleef, and then gone into the Tinkers. And that would have provided a huge Van Cleef on board, but it would have been so susceptible to more removal from Bill's side of the board. So Chess Dude choosing to keep it at 6 attack and 6 health, effectively making it only susceptible to that Siphon Soul. But unfortunately, Bill did have it in hand, providing a really clean kill on the Edwin.
Yeah, Chess Dude looks like he was fingering through his cards there, picked up the Blood Mage a couple of times, debating whether he wants it out on the board here or whether he wants to re-dagger. He's looking at his hand now, maybe thinks he needs to cycle through another threat, but the important thing is that he needs to have the answers to be able to deal with everything Bill plays at this point because he doesn't have the health to defend himself. So he needs to build that platform on the board to make sure that his removal is able to keep him in this game.
Yeah, I think one thing that you weigh when you're at this crossroads is, do I want to take the time to develop the tempo with the weapon? Or do I want to play Blood Mage Thanos, preemptively load spell power on the board, and potentially draw a card? But then if he has Mortal Coil, I might get punished. But then Mortal Coil also takes away from turn 7. You can't necessarily play Dr. Boom, so there's this trade-off. And I think Chess Dude's evaluating it, realizing that he'd rather just have the weapon, giving him more flexibility.
And you asked, Dan, sometimes you can struggle to finish the game as a Reno Lock. Arcane Golem is going to help him to do it. If he can pick up some extra combo pieces, Faceless Power Overwhelming, etc. Only 11 health right now for Chess Dude, so could be coming to a swift conclusion anytime soon.
Yeah,
it's true.
Chess Dude, so much potential in hand, but unfortunately, Bill's still at 27 health, 8 health from that anti-killbot, and then, you know, potentially up to 29 from Reno Jackson. So, sort of the same issue for both players, really struggling to close out this game with what they've got available.
Yeah, multiple options in hand here. Can play Blood Mage for double spell power, which would give him 6 damage eviscerates. We could cleanly take out the 4-7, but again, the threat from Bill early has taken away the flexibility of Chess Dude just being able to swing that dagger at anything he wants to be able to remove it from the board. He has to be so careful here as to how he rations out his damage, so it may make him have to deal with this just a little bit inefficiently.
Yeah, it's a really good point. Normally, if you were able to capitalize on your health, you'd swing in with the weapon, eviscerate for 6, develop the Tomb Pillager, but you'd be going down to 7, and that's
playing
with fire. I mean, I'm not exactly the most comfortable at even 11, right. Let alone going to single digits.
Thank you.
Yeah, as soon as you're down to 7, I'm sure Chess Dude has some idea that there is a burst finisher in this deck. So once you're down to 7, you're really not asking for much of the combo. It's just Arcane Golem plus Dark Bomb, Arcane Golem plus Hellfire, Arcane Golem plus one combo piece. There's so many combinations that would get it done.
Yeah, you cannot risk putting yourself that low. Hellfire.
There you go. That would have been 7 damage.
Yeah, that would have been the kill. So Chess Dude definitely making the right play there, not sacrificing his own health for a more efficient clear on that Twilight Drake, instead giving up the backstab. Now Chess Dude with a pretty nice board, actually, and Bill with no clear way to clear it off. He does have some defensive plays. He's got that Sludge Belcher. Kazan Mystic just not useful in any match that we've seen so far. Nobody really being able to play it and get the optimal value from it. So, you know, that would be much better if it were something like a Shredder, you know, questioning exactly what that was intended for.
Right, there have been some Kazan target decks in this tournament. We've seen Tempo Mage, we've seen a few decks that would be useful against. It's just the people we've seen with Kazan haven't really lined it up that well, so it's been a dead card in a lot of situations.
Well, what's funny is that if WTY Bill ends up winning with this deck, he won't need it against Freeze Mage,
right,
which would be something that Chess Dude has. Pretty interesting how that lines up. Sprint reloads the hand and gets extremely deep into the deck for Chess Dude. He pulls out an opportunity here to SI and clean up the board, making himself vulnerable to Hellfire. But when you see the Arcane Golem used in that fashion, I think you feel a lot more safe.
I heard you make a very little interested noise as that Arcane Golem was used to trade on the board there. It's a little came out from the side of the desk. Does seem like he's thrown away one of his possible win conditions here, but he was respecting how awkward that board was. You know, Healbot, you know, Reno wasn't really active enough to have a big impact. Healbot wasn't really effective on the board, so I guess he's decided he needed to throw away his Arcane Golem there.
Yeah, at this point, Bill is playing for the long game, but with that power overwhelming draw, if he had not played the Arcane Golem, he would have just been able to go ahead and kill Chess Dude this turn. So now he's committed to that long game, and unfortunately missing an opportunity to shut out the game so quickly.
There was just something that told me that was just like, I don't know if he gets punished. You know, when Black Eyed Peas sang I Got a Feeling, it was probably about that moment, that play right there.
Black Eyed Peas set up that song so many years in advance
just so you could
use that right now.
Will.i.am is a prophet.
That may just be the weirdest reference I've ever heard on a Hearthstone
Prophet
desk.
Will.i.am, give Bill your power to not play
Don't
the Arcane Golem. Yeah.
Don't worry, only 90s kids will get it, so. All right, well, Chess Dude now still has opportunity to play with a little bit of his health here, but I think he's first going to evaluate. Oh, it's a I was like, where is he getting his spell power from? Because it read that it was going to do 2 damage. Slight little spectator thing there. So right now, Chess Dude still has an opportunity to load up the board, and I think he has some of his best quality minions to actually pressure for a win. One of the things about Reno Jackson is that it's great to heal for X amount of health, whether it's 1 to 29. However, if there's a board already waiting for you on the receiving end, you actually have not as significant an impact as you think.
Yeah, I mean, people can get triggered by Reno Jackson extremely hard, especially if they're playing aggressive decks. But, you know, if you're playing a board-focused aggressive deck, there's ways to play around it just by playing for board control more than just straight face damage. Because, as you said, having a board is incredibly effective. Druid, one of the natural counters to Reno Lock, does it by just saying, hey, I'm going to put you in range of combo. You can Reno yourself, but I'm still going to have 14 power on board the next turn anyway.
Yeah, Bill has all the resources to sort of hold out, but now Chess Dude, more cards in hand and more damage in hand, so he's going to be able to just sort of build up that board. And Bill cannot play Reno Jackson as well as clear Chess Dude's board in the same turn, so always going to be sort of playing from behind, even though Chess Dude is so close to being dead at this point. Bill having the same problem he's had all game, just not being able to close this out.
Do you like playing the brand and TK bot before Reno Jackson, or do you like playing Reno Jackson because of stats line up better against the minions?
Yeah, it depends. You kind of have to react to board states. Sometimes, you know, you can't just evaluate and say one play's stats are better than the other. It's about the state of the board and what you need to react to. Sometimes having a 2-4 on the board can be really effective if you're against like a small cheap aggro deck like a Zoo. That 2-4 can trade really well. In this situation, I feel like maybe the Reno is slightly more effective, but also single target options against Rogue, just playing one minion onto the board for them to deal with backstab, or even sapping Reno wouldn't have been the worst thing in the world.
You know, some things I wonder if Bill actually has another form of Charger into the deck. I know it's not extremely likely at all, but it's something that I wonder, like, because he plays so aggressively on the board when he had a lot of health. Maybe there's something else in this deck.
You think we might be seeing a Leroy Jenkins in here as well as the Arcane Golem?
Maybe just a second Arcane Golem, right? He doesn't have to necessarily play one.
Yeah, interesting.
I was thinking about other outs too, but the Dark Pillar's already played. Because sometimes I see the Stone Dust Boar coming in and be a hero. You just power overwhelming Stone Dust Boar.
Just so underrated sometimes.
Basis Manip is 10 damage.
I mean, Argent Horse Rider, there could be a bunch of things. But yeah, people have messed around with builds of Reno Lock. You don't necessarily have to play 30 different cards. But yeah.
I love that Chest Dad is also becoming a hashtag. We should make a voting for that as well. Mm-hmm. Well, Chest Dude here, Violet Teacher is a very reasonable play. I think he's considering about the possibility of in the Twisting Nether completely ruining his board. But at this stage, I think you have to just go for what you can aggressively here. He's even playing the Sludge Belcher just in the off case that has a Charger instead.
Oh, wow. What a top deck from Bill. Going to be able to clear off that Violet Teacher before it gets any value.
Yeah, this is kind of a big 1-2 punch combination that Reno Jackson decks can put together, Reno Jackson Warlock specifically. But you kind of want to make sure, you want to feel confident that your opponent's committed the majority of their threats to the board. Then you nether it away, and then they're not going to have enough gas to fill up on pressure again the turn afterwards. Ooh. And then that's when you Reno with security. So I think this might be a little bit preemptive here from Bill. He could have tried to wait one turn to get some value out of it. But he's going to be reasonably happy when he sees only one possible minion here being played from Chest Dude.
Yeah, that actually worked out really well for Bill. Unbeknownst to him, Chest Dude could have just played that Lotheb next turn, shutting down the Twisting Nether and pushing for even more damage. Yeah. So actually worked out really well for Bill, and we actually saw Chest Dude's face. He looks a little bit frustrated, and, you know, rightfully so.
Right. This isn't the worst turn in the world, though. He gets to play the Lotheb on the same turn as investing a Tinker's Oil. Saw the Acidic Ooze being used. We talked about that extensively at the start, so he can feel secure holding onto this weapon without, as you said, Dan, using the Blade Flurry to get rid of it straight away.
Mm-hmm. And now Bill's in a position where, because of Lotheb came down, can't easily remove it with Reno Jackson and Dark Bomb. Has to choose what he wants to do here.
Is this the Reno Jackson turn for Bill?
I mean, he's facing down 13 damage on the board.
You have
just
to
from
imagine
what he can
it
see.
Is.
His Reno is his only defensive play, unless he wants to just Dark Bomb that Ooze, and that's his whole turn. So feels like this has to be the Reno turn. The Molten Giant draw makes you feel extremely bad about your life playing Reno Jackson, but it's just required. It's just a necessity here. You can't face down that much damage without a good defensive play in hand.
All right, but now Chest Dude has seen Bran Anti-Keelbot as well as Reno Jackson, so he's almost safe to just push for that, well, now 30 damage again. He's done so much damage over the course of this game, and we actually see in Bill's hand Alexstrasza. A pretty interesting inclusion.
Right. It's like, you know, good news, it's a fair game now. Bad news, you've already done about 50 damage and your opponent's at 30, so.
Yeah, and there's still, like, no sign that you can necessarily kill him. You're still afraid of Shadow Flame, you're still afraid of some other things, but you have to go this far in, because you're almost out of cards. Look at the Rogue's deck. Mm-hmm. It's extremely thin. It's probably got 3 or cards or less at this point.
All right, so Bill can actually do a really strong turn. Can Molten Giant or Alexstrasza? It's actually, I take that back, it's pretty awkward. If the Molten Giant were at 1 mana, then it would be so much better, but that Molten Giant being at 2 is just really, really inefficient here. He can Molten Giant, Dark Bomb on the 4-2, but
what about the Faceless Manipulator on a taunt so that way you can stop your opponent? Is that too optimistic or a waste of Faceless Manipulator?
Faceless the 4-2, play the Molten Giant, Dark Bomb the 4-2. It's
right.
So desperate at this point.
I think in Bill's position here, you have to consider the cards left in your deck. I'm not sure. I don't think we've seen a Sunfury or an Argus. He used an Argus early on with the Lothair board, yep. Make the 6/6. So I think there's probably still a Sunfury left in, which would be a fantastic card right now. But if that's his only out in terms of tapping, that's probably a really low percentage play.
Okay, ends up looking to get some value off the Faceless. I mean, the highest value would be to Faceless a Molten Giant, but he's really afraid of what might come out the other
end. Rightfully
so. And that means that is the game.
Almost out of cards.
That's exactly 12 for the 29th card drawn here. Chess Dude is just going to barely be able to end the game on exact damage. What a fantastic way to start the series.
What an uphill battle for the Rogue. Having to deal 30 damage 2.5 times, I mean, that's incredible for him to be able to actually do that.
Let's not forget, he did that from the position of being so far behind on turn 5, or on turn 4 when the Lothair was coined out.
Yeah.
That beat him all the way down to something like 11 HP, spent the rest of the game fighting for his life to get on the board, but then as soon as he got it for that one turn, all of those Rogue removal cards that are so much more powerful when they're backing up your minions on board just took over the game.
Precision and an immense amount of knowledge and skill went into that game for Chess Dude's side. I think what I love is the recognition of how the pace of the game changes as soon as certain cards are played. Right. When Arcane Golem is played, I can get away with this. But until then, I'm going to play with complete respect for this card. A really good job done by him to get that first win. And again, coming down to whether or not Bill's playing a little impatiently or whether or not he's trying to just make sure that he's playing around and respect Chess Dude a little too much. You know, maybe he's feeling like this is what Chess Dude can do. It's really one of these hard situations where we'll never really know.
Yeah, Chess Dude playing so well with that Rogue. And Bill, that Arcane Golem turn just... it seemed right at the time, but with the top deck Power Overwhelming followed by the Faceless Manipulator, ended up really being what caused him to not be able to close out the game. And I feel like, if I remember correctly, yesterday Chess Dude's Rogue played against a Tempo Mage, and the Tempo Mage decided not to go all in when it should have, the Rogue taking the win because of that. So it feels like Chess Dude has played so well with the Rogue, but maybe the class itself is holding him back a little bit, because even though he's played optimally, he's only been able to get these wins on the back of some slight mistakes from his opponent.
All right, well, we'll see how that's end up playing to the series. I know Bill's probably going to be thinking about it a lot because he wants to be a player that plays perfectly. He had a lot to say about it when we met up with him prior to the tournament.
My in-game ID is WTY Bill. WTY stands for my Chinese initials, and Bill is my English name. I'm living on Long Island, New York. I play Hearthstone and I want it to be like a competitive level. I think most people like me because, first of all, I don't play bad. And I make jokes sometimes, so I'm funny, maybe. I started my streaming June of 2014. I think it's important for me to be a streamer and also compete in this tournament because streaming makes me a better player. Have better mentality. I don't get nervous when I play in tournaments, and I get more focused. One thing I really love about fan support is they are always waiting for me to stream, like every day. I know the fans are waiting for me, so I'm gonna stream. I won't let them down. So this weekend, I'm gonna prove that you can also be a good streamer and a good player. At the beginning of last year, I was preparing to play competitively for the BlizzCon of last year. But in February, my wife was pregnant, so I gave up playing competitively. I just streamed after my wife gave birth to the baby, and now I have time to compete in tournaments. 当我被问到家人对我是对我打炉石支持多么重要的时候，我实在是无法想象出，如果没有他们支持，我会怎么样？因为 我太太非常支持我打炉石，我打炉石的时候，她有些时候做饭给我吃。Actually, my wife used to play Hearthstone, and our baby, he might play Hearthstone as well in the future. I think I'm a good, strong player because I'm focusing more on details when we play in tournaments. 这个周末如果我能拿到冠军的话，这足够我是非常屌的。I'm WTY Bill. This weekend, I'm going to play perfect games. I will make no mistake.
Bold predictions, bold claims, but if you want to be a big kickass, that's one way to do it. WTY is Bill's quest for perfection and conquering the last hill, which is to win this tournament, is quite a big one. He has to beat Chess Dude, who's up 1-0 currently in the score.
Yes, very strong words from Bill there in the video. We discussed earlier how hard it is to play optimal Hearthstone, perfect Hearthstone. Bill says that's what he's going to do. And we'll let you guys at home be the judge of that. But, you know, one or two questionable decisions in that last game. It's important not to be too results-oriented in Hearthstone, right? Yeah. You can't say he drew the damage he was going to need, therefore the play he did was wrong. But it's about probabilities. He had so many possible odds that could just push him over that last little boundary that he needed to win the game.
Yeah, absolutely. And coming in with so much on the line, I mean, he has a family backing him up, a family supporting him, and you want to make your son proud. So it's important that he does play well. But, you know, playing perfectly is so difficult to do, as you said. And maybe he almost set himself up a little bit too highly, a little bit too optimistically in the beginning. But it's important that he can just let his mistakes go and move forward and really try to play optimally from here on out.
I want to call attention back onto a chess dude who played so well in that previous game. I think a lot of people were surprised by his run through the preliminary qualifiers, because this guy was a guy playing Control Priest
right
in a pool of 128 players, and he was the only person to play his lineup. We did a lineup statistical analysis with Odin, one of the guys casting with us in the prelims, and he said Chester was the only player to not only play the priest specifically there, but also in his lineup. It was very unique. And so the way his outlook is on Hearthstone is very, very special, in my opinion. And I think we're looking at a guy that we won't see the last time for a long time. I think we'll be seeing Chess Dude in future competitions, even if he bombs out here.
Yeah, as long as he keeps having the support of Chess Dad to get him to the tournaments, right?
He's going
to
be... Love Chess Dad.
I mean, he didn't quite walk 1,000 miles, but he drove 800. I think if it's close enough,
you know,
to round up.
It's good enough for now. We'll see what happens in the future. Maybe the 1,000 miles will come his way eventually.
Whoa.
We had the discussion early on in the last game about, you know, this is probably his one and only weapon destruction, and he's using it early here to destroy just a vanilla dagger. There's a Harrison Jones in this deck as well.
So that's what he could have also felt very liberal to use it. I mean, this is very similar to how Sky High Elves also built his Reno Warlock, except he doesn't have, I think, the Arcane Golem. His differences are cards like Refreshment Vendor and playing more defensive stuff.
Bill with the Acidic Swamp Ooze in hand as well. Really, really great mechanics against the Warrior deck, especially against the Patron, where the Deathspite is so important in the coming turns. You want to get that Whirlwind effect onto your Grim Patrons, combined with Inner Rage and another Whirlwind effect. So being able to shut that turn down is really, really great for Bill.
Oh yeah, Deathspite is absolutely the party starter in Patron. Just everything hinges on that, and getting your turn four Deathspite oozed or harrisoned when you're about to set up some huge play, even just with Acolyte and Battle Rage, not necessarily even Grim Patrons, is one of the ultimate feels bad man moments in Hearthstone.
Yeah, no doubt. Although, I still feel like this matchup does tend to favor the Warlock. Especially when you load up two weapon removals.
Yeah.
That's one per Deathspite, and I think in this case, Chess Dude does have some pretty good tools in the early game. The fact that his Fighting Berserker doesn't get answered is very telling.
Right, and you know, the second weapon removal here is really, really important, because there's a feeling you can have sometimes as a Patron player where once your first Deathspite gets weapon destroyed, you kind of think, okay, I know my second one is safe now. I can hold on to it for that perfect moment. I don't need to play around Harrison Jones anymore. It's gone. But with those two weapon removals there, as you said, Dan, lining up against the two Deathspites, he has every chance in the world of just shutting down all the combo plays from Chess Dude.
Yeah, and Chess Dude actually did see that Acidic Swamp Ooze in the last game while he was playing his Rogue, so might actually be important for Bill to sequence his weapon removals correctly. If he plays that Acidic Swamp Ooze first, then Chess Dude may not know that Bill is playing the Harrison Jones. However, if he plays the Harrison first, Chess Dude might still be a little bit wary knowing the Acidic Swamp Ooze is in the deck, so it's a small choice for Bill, but it might actually make a difference.
I was really wondering about this turn for Chess Dude. The first play that stuck out to me was the slam, just because you got the cycle and you kept the Father Berserker alive. But Chess Dude is taking this time to develop a Dread Corsair for its full normal temple value. What do you think about this, Saddle?
I don't mind it, to be perfectly honest. It protects your Frothing Berserker on the board. One of the ways you can be successful in this matchup is just by tempoing out early and putting more pressure on your Reno Lock opponent than they can deal with, because the nature of Reno Lock as a deck means that if you consistently ask it questions over and over again, eventually the odds say it's going to whiff more often than most decks because of it only having single copies of answers in its deck.
Yeah, so in this case, the only real thing that could have countered Chess Dude's Dread Corsair was the Dark Bomb. 1 out of 30 in the deck, but Bill did have it in hand, so it was a a risky play for Chess Dude, but not as risky as if it were against, you know, a traditional Handlock Warlock. It's so definitely calculated.
It's a percentage play. If you keep making those types of plays over and over again against Reno Lock, you know, over your career, you'll come out ahead because mm-hmm. they are just not odds on to have that one answer that beats you.
Well, thankfully, he's young. And
he's got plenty of time. He's going to make that play thousands more times. Yeah,
for sure. And one thing I can get behind, too, is that, you know, on turn four, what do you expect from cards like Hellfire? So
right.
In this scenario, I think Chess Dude was really evaluating what can I get the maximum value off of an awkward card like that without weapons.
And Bill deciding to go with the Flame Imp and the Defender of Argus instead of the Lotheb, so pivotal because going into Chess Dude's turn six, he now has the Grim Patron, Interrage, and Whirlwind to play on the same turn.
Yeah, it's a huge turn for sure, but it's a little bit suboptimal because you can't really deal with the board of your opponent. So two of the patrons that you generate immediately lose their value. He will have the Sludge Belcher Taunt in the way that can protect a little bit, but it's not perfect. I wouldn't be surprised to see him do it because, again, ask the question, right? Do you have that one copy of Hellfire in your deck mm-hmm. that you need right now?
It is Hellfire. It also is Shadow Flame as a potential sure. ruiner as well. So those are two cards out of 30, which is just around the same amount of AoE that you would come to expect anyways at this point. He's going for Slam instead. It's a conservative approach. I don't mind it. Let's see what he can dig out. He's still looking for weapons, ultimately, is what he wants right now.
And drop the Acolyte of Pain, probably going to follow this up with the Whirlwind, clears out the Flame Imp and the Dark Peddler this way. So this is the kind of play that says, okay, I'm going to just fight for the board for a few more turns, and I think I can engineer myself into a position where either the patrons are in a better position for me or where I get a huge blowout turn on the same turn as battle raging. And then if your opponent does have that AoE clear, no big deal. All those cards have replaced themselves in your hand.
Yeah, to be able to Battle Rage the same turn as the Grim Patron is a huge deal. He picks up the second Whirlwind, but the longer that Chess Dude goes without playing that really huge Patron turn, the more likely it is that Bill will draw into that area of effect removal. So it makes sense that he wants to, you know, go forward and get that Battle Rage off to have, you know, more long-term cards in hand, but at the same time, it's very risky.
What I do like about going for the Patron play here is that you can still draw two cards by having the Acolyte go in.
This feels like a pretty great time for it to me. Perfect mana usage. You can use the Execute as well on the Emperor Thorasan. Mm-hmm. And then if it does stick, it's just so game-winning. You just start your next turn with Battle Rage, and that's basically everything you're ever going to need for the rest of the game.
Battle Rage, a.k.a. Divine Favor.
Yeah, really.
You just refill your hand to, like, maximum size. Assuming it can get to that point, WTY Bill still has the access of Life Tap to draw the AoE, but this is a dominant board position that normally the Warlock can answer easily, but there is no answer right now.
Right, and this is the strength of delaying it for one more turn. Dan, you pointed it out. It's pretty much just Hellfire at this point. Shadow Flame is not quite going to be good enough. He has the Arcane Golem and the Ooze in his hand, so with the discount of the Emperor, it does get the job done, but Hellfire is the card that you're mostly scared of here.
All right, now Bill has to make a choice. Does he go ahead and just try to play some strong minions and maybe not go for the winning play, or does he tap and try to find that one copy of Hellfire in his deck, which would swing the game so much in his favor? I mean, this is a really tough move.
I don't know about the tap. The problem with the tap is you might just die because there's 16 damage on board right now.
You might just die regardless. If you go for the Doctor Boom, then it's the strongest minion, but it's not good against the patrons. You can go for the Lotha, but at the same time, they're just going to ignore it. So in this case, I don't know that anything that's in your hand this turn could even save you.
Two damage off is what Chess Dude is right now, and Battle Rage can almost...
Oh, never mind.
Did I say two damage?
Hey, do you know what card does two
just
damage?
Just with the Doctor Order?
Yeah. Cruel Taskmaster is a bro. He comes out when you need two damage.
Exactly. Or when he reminds you that you're being a little bit too lazy playing Hearthstone in the second window.
Yep.
Stop all tabbing. Get back to work. That's going to wrap up game number two. Chess Dude up 2-0 very quickly over Bill, putting him on match point.
Yeah, huge performance here from Chess Dude. We praised his rogue play on the previous day, and we praised it again today, but now another very, very strong performance with a deck that he's not as familiar with, navigating that timing of the patron turn perfectly, picking the perfect moment. It paid out beautifully, goes out to the 2-0 lead.
Yeah, Chess Dude definitely playing his odds really well in this game. Bill, maybe not so much. Like I said in that last turn, he could have tapped and gone for the Hellfire, which would have been really his only winning card in that play. The Dr. Boom, strong on its own, not so strong up against a board of patrons. So unfortunately, Bill gonna go down another game in this series. Chess Dude looking so strong right now.
Yeah, he would have had, what, 17, 18 cards left in his deck at that point. So let's call it 1 in 17 to draw the Hellfire.
Yeah, you know,
is playing Dr. Boom better odds than that 1 in 17? Probably not. That game was probably over unless you drew exactly Hellfire.
Yeah, there is Shadow Flame as well.
Yeah,
which, yeah, you're right. It might be the best case where what's the likelihood with two or three cards remaining of drawing into the 5 damage, which is still an awkward piece for the war. They can put 4 together, 2 even, right. That 5 is awkward. Mm-hmm. I still like the play that Bill ended up making. So that wraps it up for game number 2. One game away from being able to stay alive in the tournament for Chess Dude, who we got to speak to about what is it like playing Hearthstone and chess at high levels at such a young age, and here's what he had to say.
Hi, my name's Chris Gu. My battle tag is ChessDude123. I'm 17 and I'm from Rhode Island. South Kingstown is pretty chill. Kind of matches my personality. Yeah, I've been playing chess since I was 5, and I became a chess master when I was 12. That already put me in the top 1% of chess players in the world. You know, I would have days where I just, you know, wake up, play chess 10 hours straight. I would really enjoy doing that, you know. I've played in over 100 tournaments in my life. I've been constantly ranked in the top 5 in my age group. Probably my biggest accomplishment in chess was winning the 2014 National High School Championship. I was able to also win a full scholarship to the University of Texas, Dallas. One of the biggest things I like about chess is there's always so many decisions to make, and I really like being able to try to navigate my way through the position and kind of out-strategize my opponents. I think that definitely translates to Hearthstone. Yeah, it was definitely hard to convince my parents about Hearthstone. They did not really approve of, you know, playing a video game.
We keep reminding him that, you know, this is only a passion. This is something that we don't know for sure. This is your career.
You know, after I did well in the preliminaries, I guess I was able to show that, you know, I have the ability to play well and go far in tournaments. A win this weekend would be amazing, but I guess to them, it would still be a video game.
If he wins this championship, and we'll do a lot of celebrate, but then go back to school.
Winning the winter championships this weekend would definitely be the biggest accomplishment of my life so far.
I love that, man. You know, I found the cool Taskmaster. It might be Chess Dad.
Back to work.
Back to school.
With a full scholarship,
Chess Dude gets plus 2 attack.
Plus 2 opportunities in life.
Oh, okay. Well, there
nice.
You go.
There you go.
I like it.
I kind of like
now
it.
Now we're working. All right.
Keep in mind, you are speaking to a college dropout. But yeah, I mean,
hey, me too.
I think
Chess. You've done just fine for yourself. Let's make that very clear.
My Fro Mom is really proud, at least. So taking a look at the lineup here, Chess Dude just needs one game against a lineup that is interesting to say the least. The Ramp Druid, we'll get to that in the meantime. But the Warlock here, I think, is well equipped to beat it. However, it's still fitted with a lot of interesting, like, awkward tech cards. 2 weapon removals. While it's great against Warrior, it didn't work against Warrior. And now it's going to be sitting as a liability against Mage.
Yeah, there's one pretty damn important tech card in there as well, though, Dan. That Kezzan Mystic that we've talked about whiffing a lot. So that's going to be a huge deal now coming into the Mage.
Yeah, I would love to see the tech card actually come into play and make a huge difference for Bill here.
Well, there you go. Reno Jackson, Warlock against the Freeze Mage. You definitely want to keep Reno Jackson. It's extremely important for your win condition with this deck. However, I do believe we have a resident expert in this matchup specifically, getting his degree from Oxford University. I may have embellished a little
the
bit of those details.
The degree in Freeze Mage versus Reno Jackson.
He's been published by many and considered to be one of the most handsome lookalikes and doppelgangers of Steven Seagal. We have Sottl. So, can you talk to me about this matchup? What are some of the intricacies that you really appreciate in this matchup dynamic?
At least one of those facts was accurate. I'll let you guys decide which one.
Your name?
So, this is a matchup that came out at first, and everyone went, oh, this is unwinnable for Freeze Mage, right? Like, Reno Jackson just comes out, you heal for too much, you have Brown Healbot as well. The thing is, as the Freeze Mage players got more and more refined in the matchup, they realized they could just hover the Warlock player at a really awkward awkward life total, somewhere around 20 to 22, and then force them to use their healing to play around just big burst combos with Blood Mage Thaunos, discounted cards, etc. And then that's their goal, is to get the healing used and then still have either a big Antonidas Fireball build-up turn or that Alexstrasza still to rely on to push back down to 15 afterwards. But WTY Bill's deck is a little bit more anti-freeze mage than most. We do see the Kezzan Mystic. There's also the Alexstrasza for extra healing as well.
Interesting.
The secret
are you eyeing that Finley Murgleton right now?
I am eyeing the Finley Murgleton because at a certain point, your hero power becomes a liability in this matchup.
Right.
And you can actually go the opposite direction.
See, I was eyeing the Secret Keeper here. That might just be the horrible Secret Paladin in me. But I mean, Freeze Mage, double Ice Barrier, double Ice Block, that Secret Keeper could get an Ice Buff.
Sounds like a condition you should get looked at. I have a horrible Secret Paladin inside me.
Doctor, please help.
Well, thankfully, I guess maybe the Whispers of the Old God kind of fits more of that dynamic. The Secret Paladin is whispering evil things to me. Well, one thing to consider as well is, how the Freeze Mage has been teching. We've been seeing some people replace Fireballs with Forgotten Torches, which is pretty helpful in a matchup like this. We've been seeing people cut Antique Healbot. So I'm wondering if Chess Dude specifically outfit his deck anything that would be good against WTY Bill, because we know that he has a Kazan Mystic. We know that he has the power of a whelming combination to help even rush the matchup a little bit.
Right.
Those are very useful to give him an advantage.
Yeah, also the Alexstrasza for some additional burst healing if he needs it, if there's that final all-in push from Chess Dude. But the one advantage for Chess Dude here is that he does have the knowledge that Kezzan Mystic is here, so he can play around it with full situation. Sometimes as a Freeze Mage, there's this situation where like, okay, all of these lines will probably win the game, but here's the one that also beats Kezzan Mystic.
Sure.
So,
definitely Chess Dude going to have a slight advantage over the surprise factor of the Kazan Mystic in this case. Freeze Mage, we see the standard Freeze Mage a lot of the time, Archmage Antonidas, double Fireball, but there's also the laughing Freeze Mage variant, which has the Forgotten Torches that Dan was talking about, so it'll be interesting to see exactly which kind of Freeze Mage this actually is.
Yeah, that build cuts out some of the clunkier late game stuff and tries to skip a phase, basically. Just puts more natural burn in the deck and tries to operate a bit more quickly throughout.
Chess Dude had an interesting point. I know a lot of Freeze Mages feel like if they don't get an opportunity to hero power the phase, then they feel like they're missing out. And then he goes exactly that. Now, this might look confusing, but again, Sato pointed out at the very beginning that you want to try and harass the Reno Warlock as much as you can to the point where you feel like you have to play Reno Jackson, otherwise they'll just kill you.
Yeah, it all adds up. You don't need to have any form of damage to get the job done in this game to a point, because the combination of the life tap with you pinging them in the face starts to lower their life significantly and he's already down to 19 health. So if an Emperor was to come down on this board now with this many cards in hand from Chess Dude, he's threatening lethal sight unseen, in terms of not knowing what's in your opponent's hand.
Yeah, the Freeze Mage just sort of has to keep the Reno Warlock around 20 health is pretty much that magic number where it's so awkward for them to play the Reno Jackson because they don't feel like they're getting enough value out of it. But at the same time, if they don't, after an Emperor Tharizon, it's very likely that the Mage can just go ahead and kill them from what should be a safe amount of health. So that's why the Freeze Mage is actually maybe even slightly favored in this matchup, even though at first everybody thought that it was almost impossible for the Reno Warlock to lose.
Case in point right now, two Fireballs in hand, a Frostbolt and an Ice Lance. So that's, 19 damage in total? Mana restrictions are in place, but if there was an Emperor in hand right now and an Emperor was played, that entire combination would cost 7 mana and would be castable next turn. So if an Emperor Thorazon was in the hand of Chess Dude this turn and dropped, suddenly he is threatening lethal and that Reno has to be used. But unfortunately, it's a different world and we instead have to deal with our opponent's Emperor Thorazon. So Chess Dude is a little way away from being able to threaten that kind of situation.
Sato, how high priority is this Emperor Thorazon on Bill's side of the field to remove for Chess Dude? Is it worth it for him to throw one of those fireballs at the Thorazon?
I think it has to be, yeah. It's a big deal. You do have the... Whoa!
And that fireball has gone face.
So he's saying if you don't have Reno Jackson, I kill you next turn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is, but there's multiple combinations that beat this, really, because Healbot is enough as well, right? Because he doesn't have the 19 to cover the 19 here. So
Bill has the brand Healbot in hand.
Right, exactly. I'd be okay with this. I made the point multiple times in the previous series about asking Reno decks the questions and you will get paid more often than not. But in this situation, it wasn't just Reno he could have had. The Healbot would have got the job done as well. So that seems a bit ambitious. I was about to finish my thought of saying, yes, you can afford to fireball the Emperor and go long here. Mm-hmm. Chesdu disagreed. He went for the all-in line. Does get punished.
I like it because why not? You're up 2-0. You might be able to just sweep one under the rug. And all of a sudden, Bill's out of the tournament. And you stay alive for day three. There's a lot of upside to his play. And sometimes, you know, just being able to go aggressive like that pays off.
Yep.
I don't mind the risk there.
Yeah, and to an extent, his job is done. The job that I elaborated on at the start of the matchup, get the Reno out, that's done. He's now knows it's over with. So if Alexstrasza is drawn, he can put his opponent back down to 15. But the problem is he has committed one of those fireballs, which is one of his key burst potentials. And now Bill is taking the opportunity to go with the offensive Alexstrasza here and put the pressure and the clock back onto the Freeze Mage player.
Sure.
Yeah, it feels like by choosing to go for that really aggressive fireball play, Chesdude set himself up for if Bill did not have Healbot or Reno Jackson in hand, he would have won in the next turn instead of choosing to go for the long game. But by doing that, he's almost set himself up for failure. He has so much burn in hand, but still no Emperor Tharizan, and Bill with Siphon Soul, Anti-Healbot, Bran, just pretty much every opportunity to shut down the Freeze Mage from this point on. We have yet to see the Kazan Mystic tech, but we know it's in Bill's deck. So at this point, it's seeming very difficult for the Freeze Mage to go for the long game now, having sacrificed that one fireball.
It's not as convenient to freeze the board as well. When you look at the deck from the Reno Warlock, it has that Arcane Golem possibility. Mm-hmm. And normally what you usually feel comfortable with is you just freeze the board and just keep passing. But against Bill, he's already got two cards that can really threaten some damage there. Just one card. I thought he had the Face of Manipulator. So even that Power Whelming is still threatening for a lot of damage. Chesdude has to be really careful not to get too comfortable.
Yeah, there's also the threat of a potential Iron Beak Owl just getting that 8 damage through, again, as you said, in combination with the Power Overwhelming, possibly another card. Also, by leaving that Emperor alive for so long now, you can see this entire hand can almost be played in a single turn here because of all the ridiculous discounts. So there'll be no restrictions as to how Bill is able to use his cards from this point. It's just getting those last few pieces of damage that he needs.
With a Defender of Argus draw, I wonder if Bill wants to play that to buff it up stronger against Flamestrike. I know that it's something that you're keeping in mind. He pinged Alexstrasza to 5.
Yep.
Feels a little too convenient.
Yeah, this is going to go ahead and save the Alexstrasza. Chesdude with another tough turn coming up. He can Flamestrike, clear off 3 of the minions, but Alexstrasza is still such a threat that he might have to Flamestrike and Frostbolt the Alexstrasza following it to clear off the board fully. He could go for a Frost Nova. That would allow the Emperor Tharizan to get yet another discount on the hand. We don't see Doomsayer in Chesdune's hand yet, so this is awkward to say the least.
It's not often you look at a heavy control deck's, 9-card hand and say, hey, how much mana does your hand cost right now?
Seven.
Seven?
7 mana.
It's so cheap, and these cards are super impactful too. You can Bran and Deke Healbot and still have 8 mana crystals available. quite ridiculous. Chesdude feels, I feel like he still wants to Flame Strike this, even though he doesn't necessarily outright kill Alexstrasza. I think he also can part ways with 1 Frostbolt. He's holding 2.
Yeah.
That gives Ice Lances a way to be active, even though he doesn't have Antonaze in hand.
What to do?
Yeah, for sure. Although it looks like Chesdude has a slightly greedier line here.
Okay.
Probably just going to use the Frost Nova, use the Acolyte to draw a card. I like this too, because the Flame Strike play isn't really progressing him anywhere in terms of getting forward with the game. So by getting the Acolyte on board, he is digging further through his deck because he realizes he's on a clock right now, especially up against that Kezan Mystic that he can expect to be drawn at some point.
Does make a lot of sense.
At this point, Bill's hand has been reduced so much that maybe it doesn't even matter if the Emperor stays out for another couple of turns. Like, everything is already so low in mana that Chesdude's like, well, 4 is pretty much equal to 5 in this case, so it doesn't really matter if I just let it sit.
Right. The first tick of Emperor is usually huge. If they get a second one, that's normally a huge difference as well. After it's gone off twice, you kind of feel like, all right, well, damage done. I'm just going to let that thing rock now. And there is the Kezan Mystic. So in case Bill needed any more help with this, 5 turns of Emperor that he's had on this insane board, where he renoed back up from something like 9 HP, he does draw the Kezan Mystic in good time. So he's going to be able to deal with that ice block very, very easily.
Sure. Implosion rolls for 3, and that's just enough to deny the Acolyte from drawing 2 cards and also threaten the Flame Strike.
with the clear removal.
Does fill his own board, though, which is a dangerous thing against Freeze Mages, to not have space for cards like Kezzan Mystic, like Anti-Killbot.
And the Blood Mage Thalnos was also drawn, so there's also that. I think Chess Dude is also evaluating, now that he has Pyroblast, how much damage does he have to end it? I mean, if he puts him down to 16, then he's got Fireball, 2 Frostbolts, and an Ice Lance.
Looks like he has 26.
That would be
10 from Pyroblast, 6 from Frostbolt, another 4 from the Ice Lance.
And the board's too full to play because on Mist. Oh, no, he can siphon soul.
He can do things to prevent it, but from Chess Dude's perspective, he's looking at this board and saying, okay, I have an Ice Block right now. This is a situation I can use to protect my Ice Block because Bill's put himself in this situation where he can't play Kezzan. So the correct line here from Chess Dude is absolutely the all-in Pyroblast. It's not going to pay out because Bill has multiple ways to remove his own board here. Shadow Flame, Siphon Soul, etc. So we are going to see the end of the game, but I love the recognition of the situation from Chess Dude to say, okay, if I'm going to get this done, this is the one time I'm possibly protected from Kezzan Mystic.
Yeah, a very risky line of play from Chess Dude in this game overall, and unfortunately not paying off. Bill is going to take one game, still down 2-1, but getting a win with that Reno Lock against the deck that it's essentially built to beat must feel really good.
Yeah, extremely valuable to have that Kezzan Mystic, but you can argue how many games did it take for that to get the value it wanted versus it could have been something more valuable. So, you know, the battle's not over yet. Bill is climbing back in the series ever so slowly, but now comes, can he beat Freeze Mage 3 times, not just 1 time?
Yeah, Freeze Mage is one of those decks. This was discussed with Anything Paladin yesterday, where it's a polarizing deck. It has very favorable matchups, very unfavorable matchups. So looking at what we have here from Bill, normally, that Druid would be one of those polarized favored matchups for Bill. Unfortunately, Bill has the slower, more clunky Ramp Druid list. Does have one copy of combo in there, I believe, from what we saw.
Yes.
The Force of Nature Savage Roar combo. So that can work in his favor, but you want the quicker, more effective Druid deck against Freeze Mage in this situation. Might end up being his undoing.
Yeah, and it also sacrifices one piloted Treader in place of that Senjin Shieldmaster. So making it even easier for the Freeze Mage to lock out the board, and then those sticky death rattles from the piloted Shredder actually very good against the Freeze Mage. So sacrificing that, also a detriment to that Druid deck. So it's going to be interesting to see if, you know, that Druid deck can actually come back and pick up a win in this match when it lost all 3 in Bill's match yesterday.
It's a really good point, and that might make Bill feel like he still has a chance because he still has the Force of Nature Savage Roar. It's not unwinnable by any means.
Oh, so
we're making it sound like it's doomsday. We're the doomsayers right now, which, you know.
Will we be validated, Dan?
That's the question. Hell, man, that's why you graduate from Cambridge, my man.
Thought it was Oxford,
It was Oxford last time.
It was somewhere prestigious in the UK. Let's go into game number 4 and see if Bill can climb back one game at a time against Chess Dude, or will Chess Dude finally get his ticket to day 3?
All right, so this is the matchup that haunts my nightmares. Guys, it looks like we're going to have the Freeze Mage Mirror.
I will not have any naysaying of the Freeze Mage Mirror on this desk. This is a matchup full of glory and
wonder.
I have
not naysayed. Okay. I've just said that it's a long matchup and it's very difficult. So it's going to be interesting to see how these guys navigate this match, just how much experience they have playing in this mirror, because it is so highly skilled.
It really is, yeah.
I did do a preliminary check around the perimeter. There are no Pomeranian dogs around here, so I think it's okay to say that you like Freeze Mage mirrors.
You're safe this time.
Got away.
Shout out to Brian Keeler, by the way. He'll be casting the next couple weeks.
Do you know what else? Dragons suck.
Oh! You did not realize that both of these decks have an Alexstrasza in them.
I know. Well, tell that to Kibler. It's his conflict,
not
mine.
You have to cast with him next week.
Oh, yeah, damn, that's
and
true.
It's going to be so awkward.
Awkward.
And I'm gonna
I get to go home. I'm going back to Chicago. Yeah. Good luck.
Okay.
Even Oxford and Cambridge couldn't have told you not to say that.
Now, one thing I want to point out about the Freeze Mage Mirror is that a lot of the intricacies can also be ruined by just having a powerful early hand compared to your opponent.
Right.
You have things like Alexstrasza and tools to be aggressive, and your opponent has Blizzard, Flame Strike, Frost Novas. You also could be put into this position where, unfortunately, you just get blown out. So that does exist. And I'm looking at the hands. It doesn't really seem that way for now, but one thing that could be an indicator is card draw. If you don't have anything to do early on, you're just hero powering a lot, you can be stuck in an awkward position.
Yeah, looking at the hands, Bill does have that double Frost Nova in his hand, which isn't really going to get anything done, but he does also have the Arcane Intellect and the Archmage Antonitis, which are two very useful cards. Chest Dude on the other side. Doomsayer, not a great use. Going to choose to go ahead and trade the Acolyte draws here, but he does also have that Emperor Thorasan, which is one of the biggest cards in the matchup to have before your opponent.
Yeah, it's a bit split down the middle as far as who's got the better hand at this point. Chest Dude with the Tharizan. Bill picks up the Antonitis and the Alexstrasza. More importantly right now, Arcane Intellect and that Mad Scientist, which he just drew into.
So I think he's anticipating that he's going to draw a lot of cards because he has Thanos, he has a second Acolyte, so he's already getting through. And I think he is going to prey on the fact that Bill could make a mistake by attacking the face with the Ice Barrier. Of course, generally it's a no-no. The only minion you attack with the face is probably Alexstrasza.
Yeah. Alexstrasza can deal with that Ice Barrier in one fell swoop, so you might as well get it over with. But honestly, not only do you expect them to expect not to do more than 8 melee damage over the course of the game, making just hit attacking Ice Barrier usually a heal, it also will allow them to play a second Ice Barrier if it's a card that's caught in their hand. And
true.
By not doing that, this is a matchup where you often get caught with all these awkward cards in your hand that you can't use. So just sometimes allowing your opponent just to play a card from hand when they couldn't before is of a huge benefit to them.
Yeah, Emperor Tharizan coming into Bill's hand. Unfortunately, he's got those two Frost Novas, which we said that the board clear and the board freezes are really ineffective in this matchup. Yep. Chest Dude drawing into that Blizzard. Again, not what he wants to see at this point. Both players have Tharizan, but no big impact burn spells to actually use it on.
Here's something very interesting, too, and I'm not sure how relevant it is, but Bill also used a coin, which means that he doesn't have to be afraid of his opponent getting the Thorasan before his opponent. Because normally, things like in this scenario, you want to probably even Doomsayer to preemptively stop it from doing that and secure your Thorasan, but now he can keep it and time it for something better, maybe Alexstrasza or Antonitis. And that might be a product of Bill trying to coin out something on turn one. I don't know what your thoughts on this, Otto, because you're more the expert in this department.
Yeah, in the mirror, I'm a huge fan of holding the coin if you are lucky enough to be given it. It is an extra fireball with Antonitis, as you say, and you can also use it in the other way that you described, which is just to get that Emperor out ahead, maybe get an Alex out ahead of what your opponent is, switch the momentum on that one crucial turn, get yourself a turn ahead, because Freeze Mage as a deck is very much about number of turns. How many turns do I have? How many turns do I need? So if you can use the coin to accelerate that one way or the other in your favor, that's hugely advantageous.
Yeah, so you're saying that late game momentum is even better than early game
exactly.
tempo in this situation.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, that's cute. I was thinking, why would he go for Doomsayer? But maybe his hand's not very good for Emperor Thorasan.
It really isn't.
And he wants to just do something else.
Yep. Yeah. And this is exactly the thing. You just get all these cards in your hand that really aren't all that useful, and you just kind of feel committed to having to play something. So the Doomsayer comes down here. It does set up an opportunity. It does block a potential Emperor from his opponent. I say block. Doesn't necessarily block it. You can be perfectly happy to do it, and Bill decides that, in fact, he is. It just considers this job done right now. One Emperor discount, I'll take it. But, you know, the Doomsayer still gets his job done there, which means that Chest Dude doesn't have to spend his turn reacting to the Emperor. He can play his own.
Sure. Yeah, and I think also, just to finish my point real quick, I think he also was afraid that Scientist, being able to threaten part of Thorasan too, so it limits his ability to answer it. I'm sorry, Cora.
Yeah, oh, no problem. No, I was just going to say, it's actually kind of an awkward clear for Bill on the Emperor Tharizan. He doesn't have a fireball to just get it out of the way really quickly. Can clear it off with a Frostbolt Ice Lance, or Blizzard Ice Lance might actually be a little bit better here, but Sottl, you're making some faces and look pleasant.
I just got a terrible taste in my mouth. That's a horribly inefficient way to deal with it, but at the same time, you can't really afford to leave this thing rocking on the board. You know, if he could see Chest Dude's hand, maybe he'd risk it. The hand isn't that fantastic to be getting discounted with Emperor Thorasan, but for all he knows, Chest Dude has a similar hand to what we're looking at here from Bill with the Antonitis and the cheap spells, so no surprise here to see Blizzard Ice Lance come down, but I guarantee you that Bill is not happy about this result.
Why do you think he didn't play the Arcane Intellect? If he's going to be playing Alexstrasza next turn, wouldn't you want to fill your hand as much as possible?
We need to take a look at the size of the decks, but just looking at the graphic, it looks like Bill is a significantly smaller deck size right now than Chest Dude. But fatigue is one of the ways this matchup can end more often than not. So you don't want to get too far ahead of your opponent in card draw. There we see 13 in Bill's deck, 16 in Chest Dude.
Good point. Bill actually did draw a few more cards off of that Acolyte of Pain, the first one that he had, so that could make a big difference in the long run. And one way that you can beat your opponent in the Freeze Mage Mirror without actually having to attack their face or burn their face is just to let the fatigue run out that ice block.
Yeah, as time's gone on in Hearthstone, people have found more and more creative ways of dealing with ice block without dealing with ice block. You can let them die to fatigue, you can play Dr. Boom into a Doomsayer, and then the Boombots go off and kill them. There's all these creative ways. Even we saw in European prelim, someone teched in Curse of Refarm into Warlock to do exactly that same thing.
Yeah, knife jugglers always present interesting
problems. I think that was Tarz.
It was Tarz, yeah.
Looking forward to next week for sure. Bill is going to play the Alexstrasza pretty aggressively, trying to end the game. Well, not necessarily guaranteed to end the game, but at least pushing the pace forward.
Yeah, taking the initiative here with the Alexstrasza starts to set off alarm bells in Chesdu's head, and this is where the calculations really start to come into play. How many turns do I have? How many turns do I need? Which combinations of cards do I have to put together to deal with this situation? The fatigue plan right now is probably out the window, although that Healbot draw does give him a bit of extra security to try and push this game long still.
Yeah, Healbot's really huge because that gives you extra range beyond the ice block. Because a lot of times when you put the ice block and it gets activated, then your opponent still just hero powers you down again next turn you lose a second ice block. Healbot gives you a little bit of extra longevity in this game.
Yeah, so Chesdu drawing two additional cards this turn, so he's catching himself up on the fatigue count with his opponent. Double Arcane Intellect drawn as well, so not a hugely productive turn here in terms of getting additional resources, and he does have to find a way to deal with that Alexstrasza, although honestly the first attack from it is pretty much free because the ice barrier is still up.
Yeah, not at all productive from Chesdu this turn, unfortunately. Both Arcane Intellects coming into hand. And as we said before, this game likely does go to fatigue, but with Bill's aggressive Alexstrasza, Sottl, you mentioned, it's more unlikely. So how useful do you think those Arcane Intellects are actually realistically going to be in the coming turns?
Yeah, it's debatable. Chesdu isn't quite there yet, but like I said, there's still plenty of gas left in this game, so fatigue is a consideration, but his hand's not looking quite what he'd want it to be at this point. But as I said, this having this 8-5 on the board seems really threatening, but it is essentially, he can take one attack from it for free with that ice barrier up. It's not a big deal.
Yeah, but Bill's going to be able to fill his hand with fireballs from this Archmage Ansonitis, also dealing 7 damage to Chesdu's face.
Yeah, really subtle stuff too. Chesdu attacking into Alexstrasza, like potentially threatening Flame Strike, also making sure he doesn't draw a secret from his deck because he doesn't want to get too further down fatigue. But WTY Bill getting aggressive and another Frost Nova, which is not what Chesdu wants. And he might feel like he's the one who has to play the removal game here.
Yeah, definitely he's going to need to find a way to react to this board. Alchmage Antonitis can't be just left hanging around on the board here. He doesn't have a quick enough way to counter back, so he's going to have to dedicate some resources here to getting rid of it, but it's really not too many great options for doing that right now. He has to make a huge commitment to get rid of this Archmage Antonitis.
Blizzard Ice Lance is the way you can clear it. Chesdu even playing the Thaunos, which, again, he has to evaluate how much he can dig into the deck. We were seeing that Bill was 3 cards ahead, and I think right now it's pretty much even.
Yeah, unfortunately for Chesdu, both players had very comparable opening hands, very similar starts, but Bill was just able to draw those large minions much earlier than Chesdu, and that's really all that's holding Chesdu back, is he hasn't gotten Alexstrasza, he hasn't gotten Archmage Antonitis, and even though they both had Tharazzon and both have a decent amount of burn in hand, Bill getting those huge minions earlier on just puts him at what seems like a pretty large advantage.
Yeah, and I think this Arcane Intellect here from Chesdu is now a concession that he's desperate. He needs to make sure he draws through his deck and tries to end the game before it gets to the fatigue stage. He's seen from the last few turns from Bill that it's not getting there. He's quickened the pace significantly, knows there are a number of fireballs in hand, and his ice block is under threat.
Well, now it's getting really scary because Bill can use fireballs and set up an opportunity to pop the ice block. But then you wonder if they have Alexstrasza themselves. So it's not exactly the clearest play, even though you're like, well, he has direct damage. Why doesn't he go for it? You have to be wary of what your opponent can also do. And here's another interesting thing. Bill has 2 heal bots in his Freeze Mage deck.
That's actually kind of unusual now. You usually will see just one, and then the rest of the spots are filled out with more removal. Occasionally, something like a Cone of Cold comes into the deck, but the 2 healbots, pretty useful in this matchup.
Yeah, they're actually not terrible. They can even be used in a variety of ways. As Dan said, they can extend your life beyond the ice block so you don't just get pinged down afterwards. They're also just not terrible cards in fatigue situations because fatigue doesn't care about what secrets you have up. It just cares what the actual number on your life total is. So.
That's a huge advantage for Bill if he was accounting for freeze mages, which I certainly feel like he did with the Kazan Mystic and the Reno Warlock with two heal bots in his freeze mage. He's saying, I never want to lose to another mage.
Right. And then he brings the wrong druid.
Yeah. You don't know. Maybe he has a Kazan Mystic or two.
I was going to ask, actually, Corey, you cast the series before that. Well, we didn't see a Kazan in it previously.
No, I think we saw one Senjin and one Shredder.
Okay.
Well, Bill, not really going to do anything with that Ice Barrier. Now that he's seen the Pyroblast, I think he still has to be very cautious here. But he now sees that his opponent's being aggressive as opposed to defensive. If he wants to play the defensive route, he can still pass by playing like a Frost Nova. Mm-hmm. You know, like, yep. He can still dump a card. But I don't know how conservative approach is good here. What do you think, Subtle?
Yeah, I mean, if he wants to take the conservative line, then he does have those heal bots. But again, you haven't seen the Alexstrasza from your opponent, so you don't really want to commit that healing too early. But honestly, I think he's just a little bit of burn short in able to being able to commit all the way through here and just going for the straight burn over several turns. So it looks like he is going to develop a heal bot, make a little bit of a defensive play, respect the Pyroblast to an extent. And he's going to Arcane Intellect, so that pushes him up to the range where he's going to have to Fireball his opponent's face again just to get some cards out of his hand.
Yeah, I have to imagine that they're both, again, very close on how many cards left in the deck. Early on, it looked like that Alexstrasza on Chess Dude made it so that it would not go to Fatigue, but this game is just a huge, huge game of chicken, honestly. It's whoever blinks
That's
first.
That's a good way of putting it,
and, it's so difficult to calculate all of the responses and all of the potential damage that your opponent can have because you don't know what cards were used for Emperor Tharizan. You don't know what burn might be in the hand. And Bill is still waiting on an Alexstrasza from Chess Dude, which we see in his hand. So at this point, you know, what must be going through their heads? I mean, it's crazy to think how much goes into this game.
Yeah, and I like Bill's line here, just ending up with the one Fireball going to face. 10's a nice number to put Chess Dude to because he's saying to Chess Dude, if you want to protect that first block and you want to defensively Alexstrasza, it's not getting that much value. I haven't committed that much resource to doing it. So you have to make the decision now whether you want to protect that ice block or whether you're going to let it go.
It's true. 10 health is within the Fireball, Frostbolt, Hero Power range.
Yeah.
That's one of the magic numbers. 7's also another big one, too. I like the fact that Chess Dude's also taking it. He's just taking it in strides. He says, you know what? If you end up having the Frostbolt and you pop me, I'm just going to Alexstrasza myself anyways.
Nice.
And he pings himself.
I love it.
All right. So this is going to be really confusing to a lot of players. Yeah, there is a common meme out there that things can be confusing for new players, and that might be one of them. However, we said that when you put things within range of the hero power, you set them to one. Chess Dude is playing around a lot of things by doing this.
Yeah, so Fireball Frostbolt, if cast now, would mean that the ice block was popped at 3 health, which means he wouldn't just be in range of a ping to finish him off on the following turn. This is a play we saw used at the very highest level in the World Championships itself last year in the infamous Oskaka versus Tice match at this point. So.
Yeah, so while it may seem very counterproductive to be dealing damage to yourself, in this case, you're actually giving yourself more potential when your opponent has those specific burn spells. Unbeknownst to Chess Dude, Bill does not have a Frostbolt in hand, but if he did, this would have by far been the better play. So very interesting to see that tactic come out again. I haven't seen it, you know, since that infamous Oskaka Tice freeze mirror.
Chess Dude aiming the Fireball at the face, still resolute on keeping Alexstrasza defensive, which I agree with, given the context of his hand. And he's ready to use Fireballs, he's ready to use Pyroblast. He's just gotta wait for that Antonitis to come to hand, and then he might be able to get some juice. TY Bill, by the way, has like all card draw since he's drawn that second heal.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not the most useful cards in this scenario, but he does have plenty of gas in his hand, but he's gonna have to find some way of navigating through the Alexstrasza as well, because as you said, Cora, most of his big bombs have been used. His big power plays, the Emperor, the Antonitis, the Alexstrasza, they're all gone, so he's just left with the vanilla resources in his deck to have to navigate and finish this out. And if he's not careful, he might find himself locked out of this game by a last-ditch Alexstrasza defensively from Chess Dude.
One thing to consider too is we are getting to the fatigue stages. I want to be able to do a deck check pretty soon, because if WTY Bill plays it for the fatigue, there's almost no way you can counter Alexstrasza on yourself.
Right.
And therefore, like you can set it up.
Looks like they both have less than 5 cards. It's hard to tell, but very small decks at this point.
Yeah. And Bill also still weighing his options. He's using a second heal bot very aggressively instead of waiting for any kind of action on his opponent. They're on five each, so still plenty of turns to go back and forth.
Yeah, this one is going to come down to the wire, but I think WTY Bill committing both heal bots here is recognition from his part that he doesn't have to be scared of the offensive Alexstrasza from Chess Dude anymore. If Alexstrasza is going to be used from Chess Dude and used effectively, it's going to be used in a defensive manner. So he might as well play these cards out now, since he knows he's probably not going to have to use too much more healing that's affected by Alexstrasza.
Right. The thing about the Freeze Mage Mirrors, there's going to be ice block wars of who's going to be blocking first. And if you have to use up all of your ice block charges before your opponent, they get the last say.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So if you Alexstrasza aggressively here, even though you do have follow-up burn, look, he's got Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance. That's 13.
Yes. Plus,
you know, hypothetically, you could kill your opponent in a setup.
Yep.
But your opponent's probably going to bop your ice block, and then you're just going to be caught with your pants down, and they answer it. You can't do anything about it.
Yeah, it's back to, you know, how many turns do I need, how many do I have, and the answer is not enough. So an offensive Alexstrasza play is just not going to work out. This is great recognition from Bill to evaluate that situation correctly and realize that he doesn't need these heal bots.
Another ping to the face.
That's exactly what Chessu needed to do in this case, because Bill set
like
it up perfectly for a fireball ping to the face to pop that block at one.
Sick.
Instead, Chessu making that impossible for him. This is some really high-level Freeze Mage play.
It is, and I'm loving it. This is fantastic. Chess Dude is really continuing to impress me every time I watch him play. First, it was just with his rogue play, but he's shown excellent navigation of his other decks here today as well, really proving that he is a standout player in this tournament.
Yeah, I think even though Chess Dude's making the flashy plays, again, I'm pretty impressed with Bill being able to weigh his situation.
Yeah.
A lot of times you might think, you just never play Arcane Intellect and whatnot, but he's recognizing Chess Dude's hand, his plays. He must be desperate. I can get away with this. Both players are playing excellently. That's not Antonitis from Chess Dude, and he's still floundering right now. Needs some extra burn. Is it time to play Alexstrasza defensively? It's still one of these really hard questions to weigh.
It's
tough to say.
So awkward. Every ping changes the math significantly on what deals with you, because he pinged himself to 6 so that Fireball ping wasn't able to pop the block and leave him at 1. But then in a couple of turns, Frostbolt ping is going to do the same thing when he's at 4. So these red flag turns keep coming up for Chess Dude, and he's going to have to accept at some point that either his block gets popped or he has to choose to put a stop to the downward spiral and just play the Alexstrasza defensively.
If you play Alexstrasza defensively, your opponent will probably spend a turn having to deal with Alexstrasza eventually as well. But
The first Alexstrasza attack is free because of the ice barrier, so he doesn't necessarily have to commit to dealing with it straight away.
You've got the second ice barrier in hand anyway, so it's not especially worth sacrificing your resources to remove at this point.
All right, big turns, pink face pass.
Oh, feels good.
Yep. Double Doomsayer. So, yeah, as you mentioned, Dan, Bill has just gone card draw, card draw, card draw, Doomsayer, Doomsayer for his last draws since using the Arcane Intellect. So the bottom of his deck is not quite as effective as Chess Dude's is, but Chess Dude would have loved to have some of those big power cards earlier that Bill was lucky to get. So he is now sat with just looking at the last few cards in his deck, hoping that these important last few pieces are going to come out that he needs.
I don't believe we've seen a second Ice Lance from Bill. So he used one defensively.
One on the Emperor.
Yeah.
We also, I'm not sure if we've seen Flame Strike, so I'm willing to bank that those might be two out of the three or four remaining cards here. He's going to extend the life here of.
Oh, this is actually really clever.
With the Ice Barrier armor
cool.
And then ping it down. That was great math from the thing. We usually say that you can't pop the ice block and you can't really pop the ice barrier even, but he's thinking, no, I'm actually adding to it.
That's really cool, and it's worth noting as well that Chess Dude had the opportunity to ping off the antique Hillbot on the previous turn and chose to ping face instead, which has a significant impact on what happened there. So
that's brilliant.
Yeah.
Yeah, something that Bill caught Chess Dude not paying attention to. And so even though this was a very high level game, it's not, I mean, just like you said, it's so
not
hard
perfect.
To play flawless from start to finish.
Especially in a match like this where, like I said before, there's so many different factors coming into play, and it's so difficult to calculate all the different damage points that your opponent can do to you at one time. So, that's
sick.
Just great play on Bill's side.
That was awesome. Well, Chess Dude, what are you going to do now, man? you don't have the ice barriers. If you're going to play, that's a great question, Jaina. Like, what do you do from here? If you play the ice block again, you're just going to get it popped. If you play Alexstrasza, you're looking at 6 damage already on the board, so you're actually only healing for 8.
Yeah, I think you almost have to use the ice block here and then use the rest of your turn to address this board and then hope that you can defensively Alexstrasza next turn in a better position after losing your second block. Hope there isn't enough total burst left in your opponent's deck. Chess Dude will have calculated how many Antonidas spells were gained, how many have been used, how much natural burn is left in the deck. He's going to try and find a way through this. Did he rope? I really hope for the sake of this game that he managed to get through that. He did.
That's
so rough for Chess Dude.
That's disastrous.
I think he was calculating if he can burn his opponent down to fatigue.
Right.
But I think Chess Dude also hits fatigue a turn earlier before Bill, last time I was checking the card count. He would also be in an awkward position to be accomplished that.
Mm-hmm. A mental fatigue showing on Chess Dude as well. Obviously, that's so frustrating to whiff 4 mana, especially at a high level of tournament play like this in a game that has been going on for so long and has been played so well up until this point. But yeah, that's really awful to see that something that happens.
I would have loved to see it. Both players have been playing great in this game, and I would have loved to see it reach a conclusion based on one player playing spectacularly. Mm-hmm. So, see Chess Dude Maker obviously just ran out of time mistake there. It's disappointing, but if Bill wins because of that, he's a deserved winner because Chess Dude has didn't conform to the rules of the game, didn't fit his time into the rope. So,
and Chess Dude, if he had managed to clear the board there, set up for a defensive Alexstrasza, has more burn potential than Bill at this point, so would have actually been in a decently favorable position.
I love this. I love that play. It's so good. He knows the last gasp hope here is defensive Alexstrasza, so he says, well, sorry, that Alex isn't going to get to stick to the board. It just dies here.
Yeah, definitely. Again, you're always, bring it up, the Alexstrasza isn't irrelevant after a certain point. And so you're just going to stop it. And you also give yourself initiative by doing so.
Yep.
Bill has...
He has 6, 9, 10, and but the Blood Mage as well.
Ice Lance is the last remaining card, I believe.
Mm-hmm. If we've kept count of it correctly, I would go with you there. I think the Ice Lance is the last remaining card, so...
Not quite enough this turn with the fatigue. It looks like it's still just a waiting game for Bill.
Yeah, but it's a waiting game that he's going to win. If he recognizes his deck in the same way that we have and he knows that the last card is Ice Lance, he knows he just needs to basically time walk this turn, which, Doomsayer is pretty good at doing that. So.
And Chess Dude is also going to be on fatigue first before his opponent. Flame Strike's not going to be any more beneficial. And if he gathers the damage now by using Antonidas, Frostbolt, and Ice Lance, then his opponent will have enough to put him at 13, to do 13, mm-hmm. and then let him die the fatigue damage. So this should be checkmate on Chess Dude.
Talk about a chess game in Hearthstone. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I mean, this is probably the closest analogy we can get to into a game of chess, right? It's such a long, drawn-out matchup, so complicated, and honestly, navigated spectacularly well by both players. There was one or two minor mistakes, but as we've talked about, impossible to play this game perfectly, even in more straightforward matchups, let alone one as complex as this. And you could even say that the mistakes from each player have been forced by the excellence of the other player. So,
gonna go for it, but we know that Bill's last card should be Ice Lance, and unless I've miscounted, and I'm willing to accept that I'm wrong.
I'm trusting you, Dan. I'm trusting you.
I'm assuming it is. We don't have an ability to track outside of that.
All right, let's find out. Fireball.
Well, that works too.
That's fine.
That's basically Ice Lance. It's fine.
Yeah, because Bill can deal 13 and then Chess Dude fatigues for 1.
Also, that's barrier, not block, so he doesn't actually need. Yeah, he can just deal the damage raw. Like Fireball, Crossbow will do the job. It's fine.
All right, there it is. And I guess maybe we miscounted the Ice Lance, but it's all right. Casters make mistakes too, as well as the players. In this case, Brodan makes mistakes. And Sottl is brilliant as always.
Yeah, well.
Didn't even need a Guinness beer for that one. So congratulations, game number 4 is basically done and under the wraps here. Taking a look at how it's panned out, we're gonna have to have Druid versus the Mage as the final game.
Again, it's coming down to Bill's unique ramp wall-style Druid with only one copy of Force of Nature Savage Roar.
Yeah, and let's be very clear, that's a dramatically different matchup from the aggressive build of Druid that we see with piloted shredders, double combo, all that stuff that Freeze Mage hates. Sticky minions on the board, damage from hand. That's the double whammy against Freeze Mage of the two things you want. So, the ramp Druid is kind of missing that. Less consistent damage with only one copy of the combo, and the minions slightly less sticky in terms of death rattles, although some of them do have huge health pools. But health pools don't really care about being frozen and Frostnova Doomsayer, etc. off the board. So,
Chessdude with an overwhelming support behind him to win this match. But Bill has been hard fought in fighting his way back, so at this point, it's still up in the air.
I think all the rogue players are starting to rally behind Chess, dude. They're recognizing, man, this kid's got skills. And it's also really exciting to see, you know, fresh blood really enter the scene. Bill's more of an established player. He's a streamer. He actually has a lot of popularity. But, you know, Bill's on a quest himself. Chess, dude, says he wants to be great at Hearthstone and chess and dominate both. Bill says he wants to prove that streamers can be good at Hearthstone too, Sottle.
Wow.
And that might be even a harder mission to accomplish than being good chess in Hearthstone.
You're telling me you can stream Hearthstone and also win Hearthstone tournaments? This is a thing you're allowed to do?
I don't know if I believe it.
So I heard, but I mean, Bill is trying to make that a reality.
Damn.
I guess we'll find out.
But like, all joking aside, whichever one of these players wins this deciding game five, I think you can say we have a worthy winner in this matchup. I've been really impressed by both of these players throughout the tournament, so happy to see either one of these guys advance through.
Yeah, I think some of the nerves maybe of day one that might have caused some suboptimal plays, some misplays are out the window now, which seems so strange because this is, you know, a dire situation. Whoever loses this match is out of the tournament, and whoever wins is going to be going on to tomorrow for another decider match. So the stakes are incredibly high.
They are. Looking at the opening hands here, double zombie chow from Bill, you know. Sure, like not the most impressive thing against Freeze Mage.
Look at the
damage will probably be healed back, but yeah. One, his hand is beautifully symmetrical right now. Two, if you're going to have these zombie chows on the board at any point, they might as well be in the early game. It increases the density of your deck. You don't draw them later on. They may be able to get in some chip damage so that the death rattle healing doesn't have its full effect.
I'd still consider throwing back a zombie chow as well. Just because it's like you said, the damage still feels slightly negligible.
Right.
So
just send it back in there, hope he never comes out again.
Yeah. Because you're going to be dependent on drawing other cards. You have Innervate. Why not Innervate into something strong as opposed to having Zombie Chow? And then you're in the situation where it's great to Innervate the Belcher the following turn. But if you just draw spells like Wrath and Swipe, then you're just sitting duck.
Yeah, I think that's totally fair. It was definitely a consideration. It's something that I wanted to talk about, but Bill just mulliganed a little bit too quickly for me. But I can totally see the scenario of, well, if I'm going to play this card at any time, it might as well be get me turn one.
You're absolutely right. As soon as things go on, Flame Strike and Doomsayer stuff really sabotages the integrity of whether or not Zombie Chow is worth playing at all.
Yeah. Yeah, well, fortunately for Bill, he has drawn into that Sludge Belcher, going to help him curve out the next turn. But after that, if he draws, you know, Wild Growth, Darnassus Aspirant, some dead cards, it's going to be really hard for him to keep up. Bill can actually Innervate into the Druid of the Claw, kill off that Doomsayer if he wishes to.
I don't hate it. Yeah, I love this. Innervate Druid of the Charge, get rid of the Doomsayer, keep the initiative on the board. Normally when you see a tempo Doomsayer like this come down early, it's because they have a powerful three mana play that they want to have time to do. Arcane Intellect, drop an Acolyte on the board, develop a secret. So shutting them down like this, continuing to make those much discussed zombie chows a problem. They're still, you know, pounding away at this point. So the longer he can keep them around, the better chance they have to deal more than that five damage that they'll heal afterwards.
Well, Chessdude has some options at this disposal. Arcane Intellect is guaranteed more draws. Acolyte of Pain is halfway. You get a draw and you gain some health.
Yeah, I think
it is coming down to the turn of Keeper of the Grove as well.
Right. I think you can just go ahead and Arcane Intellect here. It's not that much damage on the board, 8 damage in play. So just drawing cards here, you know you're going to get a heal from those zombie chows at some point. You know this is a less aggressive druid list than normal, so you don't have to be super concerned about your health the entire time. So the card draw play with Arcane Intellect seems perfectly solid here.
Yeah, Chessdude definitely doesn't have to be worried at this point. Ice Barrier is going to give him the full 8 health, anti-Keelbot as well, so not really under a clock as of yet, especially with Bill only having one copy of the combo in deck. Swipe, not too useful. Innervating that Sludge Belcher is okay, but you also don't want to have to waste one mana, so it's tough. Bill has 2 Ancient of Wars in deck, which would be much better uses of that Innervate, also Ancient of Lore, which would be really nice, so it's kind of tough in this case.
I do like the idea of building up the armor count against Freeze Mage.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of times people are focusing on the damage Druid can do, but even just hero powering every turn can be extremely relevant to whether or not you're be able to survive the Alexstrasza push.
Right. When people talk about armor resisting Alexstrasza, everyone focuses on the warrior. Druids can do it too, not quite as effectively, but even, you know, three or four armor when Alexstrasza comes down can make all the difference and cost the Freeze Mage one extra turn.
All right. Well, Chess Dude has, again, more options at his disposal, but in the end, now it's starting to get to the point where he probably doesn't want to take too much more damage. So what is he going to do defensively here? Or you think he's going to even potentially drop the Accolade, but I think that's too greedy.
Yeah, I think that might be approaching the point of being too greedy. He may choose to deal with this board state, try and get the healing back from the Zombie Charles, buy himself a bit more time. He can afford to use a Frostbolt here for sure if he'd like to, but honestly, I wouldn't. I mean, if he was to Acolyte Coin Ping his Acolyte, I wouldn't call that outright wrong for sure.
Yeah, from this point on, the Zombie Chows are actually doing, you know, positive damage. They're going to be doing more damage than they heal back. So, Chess Dude still not under a whole lot of pressure by killing them now. He'd be at essentially 30 health again. But it's important to note that now keeping the Zombie Chow in hand actually has dealt a positive amount of damage to Chess Dude.
Very, very true. Oh,
by far it has. I mean, look at it, the case right now. You'd only heal at 25, but it doesn't look like Chesty was going to answer it directly, so you get even more chip damage in. But in the end, with two blizzards in hand, which is definitely an important distinction to make, not every Freeze Mage runs two blizzards, Chesty will be able to stall for quite some time, and Bill's got reactive cards. He doesn't really have a big bomb that you're expecting from a Druid deck. Emperor Thorsen, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's just the nature of this build, although Ancient of Lore is a fantastic draw here. Sometimes a concern from Druid players that they want to hold onto it in terms of using healing in case they need it to be defensive after the Alexstrasza, but with his hand, the number of resources in hand from Bill, and as you said, too many reactive cards, he absolutely does need to cycle through and get some pressure here, and there is some nice pressure.
Well, there you go. You have Force of Nature, you have 12 damage onto the board.
Yeah, and usually as the Druid, you're not going to be able to use both Ancient of Lores for health following that Alexstrasza. So using one for cards is fine, and then finding the second one, you'll likely end up using that for health. That combined with the armor actually can be enough to keep you alive post-Alexstrasza turn. But drawing cards now, drawing into a follow-up turn for next turn 7 with that Ancient of War is much more important than saving the Ancient of Lore for health later on in the game.
Yeah, it's for sure an additional concern in this slower build of the Druid, though. Normally when you're playing the fast, aggressive Druid, you don't really care about healing after Alexstrasza because your goal is to put so much pressure on that they can never activate that offensive Alexstrasza into two-turn kill. But in this deck, you're probably going to be drawn out a bit longer, so you may have to defend against an Alexstrasza at some point, but I totally agree. With the poor hand that he had, pulling for resources there with the lore makes a lot of sense.
I think Game Hunter, not going to be bad. Useful against the Alexstrasza, but likely not going to get any damage to face, so it's nice to have maybe a little bit preemptive right now, a little bit too soon, but still not bad overall.
Yeah, I think Ancient of War still has a lot of merit onto the board. I think you're slightly afraid of the follow-up on 7 because he did Blizzard. Blizzard into Flamestrike is a really common setup, but that would still mean the Ancient of War is safe. As long as you root it, I mean, there is this
Root!
Wow,
Bill,
this guy is a badass!
Taking a huge chance right here.
What?
Wow.
That was a play for his family.
Yeah, I was going to say, Bill is making the plays here, maybe not to win the game, but to win the hearts of Twitch chat, and we all know that's what matters.
Bill knows he's behind in the polls, and he wants to bring those numbers up.
Oh, goodness.
No, but it's a calculated risk. Bill knows that Chess Dude might have Flamestrike, but he doesn't have enough mana, even with coin, to use Flamestrike and a ping, so this Ancient of War will likely live. It was a calculated risk again. The Blizzard, unfortunately, going to shut it down.
Bill.
Chess Dude healing for 10 health off those Zombie Chows, but what a chance.
Oh, Bill, what have you done? You've broken Frodan. He's just over there in the corner.
I don't know, man. I don't know about that. All I know is we got to see an uprooted Ancient of War.
Pretty
but it didn't work out. My heart is broken. I don't know what to say anymore. All I do know is that Bill is still in trouble because he doesn't actually have a good follow-up. He could try to get value off of his minion by silencing it.
Right, but it sightens it back to 5 attack. Right. He wouldn't get the full up root value, which kind of sucks. Probably isn't worth it in the long run. He's just going to use the keeper to go for the board control play instead, get some damage in with swipe.
Right, and you can maintain the 10 attack threat. So at this point, Bill is already established that he's brave, to say the least.
Yes.
But he's kind of not exactly got a really good fallback plan. And Chess Dude at this point can still take his time. He can definitely isolate that that Ancient of War install. He's definitely not going to be in a situation where he won't have enough damage to end the game because, again, Bill has less removal options. He's got more big threats. So the moment he ever gets, like, Antonitis and he knows there's no more silence, then he can just kind of continue to climb back. So I don't mind using things like Ice Lance to stall or even using Frostbolt liberally.
Yeah, but Bill's already got that copy of Force of Nature in hand. We know he only has one combo in deck, so drawing into the Savage Roar is unlikely, but if he did it, it would be able to lock out the game pretty soon. So he's just looking to deal those final points of damage before the combo would be an out for him, because that might be his only way to win this game.
Yeah, for sure, but I love the play to just freeze it, ping it down to 1 health here, put it on the later base, deal with it next turn. Again, there is maybe an argument to try and get that 5 damage in right now by silencing with the Keeper of the Grove, because it's the last use you'll ever get out of it. But it does still seem a bit too cute. If you're going to silence something in this matchup, you want to be silencing Doomsayers and then potential concerns for Mad Scientist and Acolyte of Pain as well. So it seems like much better uses for your silence effects than just digging in a few points of damage.
The wisdom of Sottl. In a high-level Hearthstone tournament, don't play cute.
Yes.
Second Keeper of the Grove being used, and that is one of your best answers to Doomsayer. And I think Bill is recognizing that this is not the time to be worried about that. Let's just play into my Force Nature Savage Roar. I think I'm in a very poor spot. He even is willing to bump into this Loot Hoarder to prevent Chess Dude from picking up an optimal AoE strike.
Well, Bill has seen both Blizzards at this point, and Chess Dude has kind of been telling that he doesn't have Flamestrike in hand. So this is, again, one of those calculated risks that we've seen Bill take throughout this series, but it's actually really nice.
It is, for sure. He has to try and make the plays to win here, and with only one copy of combo in his deck, he is slightly less likely than usual to draw that Savage Roar to go with the Force of Nature, but he does have to make the risky plays here to get something done.
Oh my goodness. Well, Chess Dude from this position has, not the Antonitis, the Thoris in here. Gonna remove also that uprooted Ancient of War, and I don't think he's gonna be afraid of dying to the Force of Nature Savage Roar. If he still feels like that, does he? I think he can still play the Ice Barrier.
Ice Barrier,
safe.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I believe so. The 10-1 comes off the board. There would be 6-8 in play, plus 14, so 22, 28. So yeah, he's at 30, it'd be 28 damage. So yeah, get the value out of the Ice Barrier while you can.
Harrison Jones not handy in this matchup. Bill looking for that last bit of damage to close out this game. Shredder's really nice, but he's also now has to kill this Emperor Tharason. It's so dangerous to leave it up on the board, but if he does that, he's sacrificing the damage that he does have to potentially win this game.
Oh, not
Captain's
a good outcome.
Parrot.
You know, Harrison Jones is still not too bad. It's a 5-attack minion, so still extremely relevant. And your opponent didn't Flamestrike last turn, which was probably a board you would have gone for. Mm-hmm. So I still think Harrison is not the worst outcome, although, you know, you're not exactly happy that it's not Ancient of Lore number 2, for example.
Sure.
Yeah, obviously you're very at risk whenever Chess Dude does draw that Flame Strike. Even, you know, Frost Nova would be pretty good here. He's used both Blizzards, so that's not going to be an option. Archmage Antonitis.
That's crazy.
It really is.
You can play Antonitis with Frostbolt and Ice Block and start to threaten that your opponent can't answer. He's played 2 Keepers of the Grove. Mm-hmm. He plays Swipe as well. So yes. It's like, how do you remove it with just a few power on the board? You need to have Wrath or something else.
It forces Bill to use that Force of Nature at this point, which is the only copy he has in the deck. So by playing the Antonitis, comboing it with a couple cards for Chess Dude, Bill's only option is to get rid of his burst damage in order to get rid of that Antonitis. So this is a great pickup for Chess Dude. Really, really nice play.
And I wanted to make that point on the previous turn. Dealing with the Emperor last turn, I think that's a situation where a regular double combo deck would have heavily considered using their Force of Nature to clear that out and maintain all their minions. minions in play, but with only one copy of Force of Nature in Bill's deck, he decided to sacrifice some of his minions on the board to do it instead. But if the Antonidas were to have come down there, then I'm sure the Force of Nature would have forced to have been used.
Yeah, that's actually an interesting play. Chestu decided not to go with the Archmage Antonidas, played out the Acolyte, pinged it, and then fireballed the Harrison. He does pick up that Flame Strike, but not getting the immediate Antonidas value. Sottl, what do you think about that play versus dropping Antonidas right now?
I like the Antonidas play. I think we discussed it quite heavily. With all the removal being used, a huge body just on the board against Druid is such a huge problem to deal with. They're not very good at removing your stuff while they pressure you at the same time. It's not a thing they do well. So even if he did have to spend his turn dealing with it, you'd be kind of okay with that. It's a free turn for you where you've got something pretty awesome done with the Fireball generation, and the Druid hasn't really progressed forward. So I was a big fan of the Antonidas turn that turn, but Chess Dude obviously knows what he's doing.
Wow.
He's navigated things brilliantly so far, and the Alexstrasza draw here is huge.
Massive. I mean, the fact that he can now go on the offense, Chess Dude can start pushing for the lethal. He's got Power Blast in hand. That could be the beginning of the end of this series. By the way, I do want to point out that Bill wrathed his own captain's parrot, and he uprooted his Ancient of Orton. Looks are deceiving.
Cute plays.
Listen, Koro, looks are deceiving, but Bill is one of the most manliest men I've ever seen in Hearthstone.
Absolutely. Bill just really
he'll drag
proving
the sword
that
deeper.
He came here to win.
He'll drag the sword deeper into his gut so he can get to closer to you.
Meanwhile,
well
in the
put,
game
Dan.
Of Hearthstone that was ongoing,
well
Chestnut is considering whether to make this Alexstrasza play, but it looks like he's going to favor the Antonidas first this time, generate his fireballs, then go for the Alexstrasza play, so he has a quicker chain of events after the initial Alexstrasza towards getting lethal.
Sure, and the board has also been controlled. Bill still can remove, but in the end, how is he going to win?
And a Frostbolt sent face there to perfectly remove the amount of armor that Bill had built up. So the Alexstrasza will now come down cleanly and set him down to 15 health, maybe 16 if he hero powers this turn as well.
Kael'thas'dod is cool. He's a really interesting
he's a cool
card,
guy. But
yeah. We like him. We'd invite him to parties, but unfortunately here he's not too useful.
We'll see. I mean, Bill might have some surprise in the deck, but at this point, you'd rather have a card like Ragnaros instead of Kael'thas'dod against the Freeze Mage. Chess
at this
dude.
Point, you'd rather have double combo. Yeah, it's such a shame to see this Druid list struggling so hard because it's creative. It's nice to see something different. Unfortunately, mid-range double combo Druid just so hard to do better than.
Well, never say never. I mean, one of these things is Bill also might pick up a way to heal with Ancient of Lore, and then Freeze Mage doesn't have damage to finish. It's not out of the realm of possibility that Bill still wins this game, although I'm just giving a pretty significant advantage to Chess Dude.
Ice Lance drawn here. The Frostbolt was used in the previous turn with the Antonidas, so he's short an activator for that in hand right now. The Pyroblast and the Fireball plus Ping is 17 damage, so that's the line he can go down over the next two turns. But he is just going to consider his outs against things like the Ancient of Lore to heal, possibly Lotheb as well. I don't know if that's a card you saw yesterday in this deck, but it's something that you always consider when navigating these turns as a Freeze Mage.
Sure. If Lotheb is played, then you want to play Pyroblast first so you can still Fireball, but then
you can't fit the ping in as well as the Fireball.
In.
Yeah.
Yeah, I suppose so.
But I think all things considered, this has to be the line. Two cards in hand, you don't have to play around much when there's two cards in hand. The odds are very heavily in your favor. They're not going to have any particular outcome.
So assuming this is Bill's withdrawal, Chess Dude will win. He's even considering holding on or using the Ice Lance. And that Savage Roar is too late.
Roar, oh.
It won't do anything.
Yep, no outs here for Bill. He's just not going to be able to find a way to solve this. And Chess Dude has navigated a game of Freeze Mage against Druid without ever having a secret in play outside of that ice barrier.
Fantastic series. Chess Dude stays alive, sending home Bill to his family, saying better luck next season. For now, the 17-year-old Phenom continues his run in the America's Championship.
I'm so impressed. So impressed with Chess Dude. Day one, it was a little bit shaky with the other decks that weren't Rogue, but as you said, Cora, new experience for the kid. He a few nerves on his side, but day two, we really saw him tighten up and just exhibit incredible control of the entire range of his lineup.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm so excited to see, you know, another young man come into this tournament and show that, you know, this is not a child. It's not necessarily a children's card game, but that there is, you know, younger people can come in and show that they have such a mastery of these decks.
He's chess dude.
He's
not chess
dude.
Boy.
No, but everybody always gives Amnesiac that tag of, you know, child prodigy, but chess dude, only 17 years old, shown such prowess in other competitive games such as chess, and now here he comes in and shows that he has such a great handle on the decks that he's brought. Really impressive gameplay from both guys, actually.
Yeah, a long way to go for chess dude, but I think it's very possible that we've sort of just seen the beginning of a star in the making from chess dude. Hugely impressive player.
You heard our thoughts. Let's hear his thoughts. He's waiting with Robert for a few words on his victory.
Thank you, guys. Chess dude, congratulations on the win. You were able to stay alive, advance to tomorrow, where you will be playing Snail. Have you had much of a chance to study him at all?
Well, of course, I played him yesterday, and I didn't end up doing too well. But, you know, everyone here is a good player, and I'll definitely do my best to prepare for tomorrow.
Your deck or your lineup is a little bit different than some of the other people brought. It's much less aggressive. It's much more based on control and kind of high-level decision-making. What was your reasoning behind bringing that lineup?
I think a big part of my decision in choosing the decks I chose is that I just really wanted to bring decks that I enjoy playing the most. And I think that would, you know, it's allowed me to have the most fun at, you know, tournaments. And, you know, I play these decks mostly Rogue, but on ladder. But I also play these other decks on ladder as well. And I just enjoy more control, combo-oriented decks a lot more than, you know, more aggressive ones.
Right. We actually looked up, and over more than 10,000 games played, you have 48% of the games were played as Rogue, and you had a 60% win rate. So obviously, that is a deck you have mastered and you feel most comfortable with. But did you feel any nerves? Obviously, you have a long-standing tradition of playing chess at an extremely high level. So coming into this, were you feeling nervous at all in any of your matches?
I'm pretty sure everyone has to feel nervous at this big of an event, but I think I did well to, handle my nerves pretty well. I've had lots of experience, as you said, in chess tournaments, and I think that's helped me be able to handle my nerves better.
Awesome. Well, great job today. Great job beating your opponent. You're going to be going on, as we said, tomorrow. We're going to go ahead and sign it over to the sidebar, where we have TJ, Reynad, and Savige waiting to give their analysis on the match.
Thank you very much, Rob. And once again, congratulations to Chess Dude for moving on to the decider match tomorrow. I'm here with Reynad and Savige. We're going to help break down that match a little bit. And I want to start off by coming to you, Reynad, talking about this Freeze Mage, because Freeze Mage was a deck that we saw a lot in preliminaries, but not so much in the championship here. What's your thought on Freeze Mage and its place in the current tournament meta?
It's a fantastic deck to bring, especially if you're already bringing Rogue. It has a lot of the same kind of good and bad matchups, so it's really good for trying to make it very difficult for your opponent to win with one specific deck. Mm-hmm.
And Savitz, the Druid seems to be a weak link for Bill. It's more of a heavy ramp style instead of faster with combo. What have been your thoughts so far on that Druid deck in particular?
Well, when I saw the deck the first time, I had my own doubts, seeing the Kel'Thuzad. It's a little bit of a clunky card. It's an expensive card that's hard to play efficiently. You already need to have some minions on the board ready to trade in order to get some value out of it, and did not work out this time.
All right, well, let's get into some of the clips that we're going to break down here. The first one was from game number one. It was Bill playing the Warlock and Chess Dude playing the Rogue. And Bill's getting very close here. Chess Dude had used his weapon early on in the game to clear off some of the board. He's down to 11 health. Bill has the Arcane Golem and the Hellfire here, so he's like a power overwhelming away from being able to close out the game. And he actually decides to clear the board with it, use it to clear the board. Reynad, why do you think he made this decision, and do you think it was the right one, given that next turn he drew the Power Overwhelming?
I mean, all the other alternatives this turn for Bill are pretty clunky, and so it makes sense that he would go for the Arcane Golem play. It's very tough to deal with his board in any other way. In order to use all your mana, you would have to maybe run out of Brawn without getting any value out of it, or maybe Life Tap from a losing board state against Rogue, which is very dangerous. So, I mean, you know, Bill acknowledges that he's behind on board. He acknowledges that Chess Dude might have a sap, and I can't fault him for making this play, even if it didn't work out for the best.
Yeah, certainly. The Arcane Golem is a card that you want to keep for later on to combo it with a Faces Manipulator, maybe Power Overwhelming. But I believe that in this particular situation, the heals were a little bit off. You can't get the full value out of it. And if you just Belcher, there could be a sap and some spell damage or some spells to potentially kill him off.
Yeah, and we can see here as the clip finishes up that Bill did draw into the Power Overwhelming next turn. And one thing to point out is that he actually was at 23 health. So he might have thought that potentially he was going to win the long grindy game. He didn't need to wait for it because Chessy was already so low. Do you think that maybe played into his decision that he thought he would win the long game?
Yeah, I mean, usually with or without combo, if the game goes long, the Warlock is going to be favored. And I will say that Bill making that play is just the sign of a really good player because a lot of people feel like they should never play that charge minion unless it's killing their opponent. But, you know, he shows some flexibility in his thinking.
Yeah, and let's take a look at the second clip. This one we're going to head to game number three, actually. This was in the Freeze Mage Mirror. And I know there's some people at home that don't have much experience with Freeze Mage who might have thought these next sequences of plays were a little bit weird. But Chess Dude's at 10 health, and he actually goes ahead and pings his own face to put him down to 9. Savitz, why did he do this?
The reason why he did that was that he did not want Bill to pop the ice block at 1 HP, because that would be a huge problem for him, and for the reasoning that the hero power would be popping it again on the following turn. So he was worried about combination of Fireball, Frostbolt, dealing 9 damage, and then the ping popping at 1. So by pinging himself, if there was a Fireball, Frostbolt in Bill's hand, it's just from 9 HP, it's clunkier, and he will pop at 2 HP instead.
Yeah, and Reynad, what types of things are you looking for in the Freeze Mage Mirror? Because it's a really, you know, technical matchup. When it comes down to it, there's a lot of intricacies. What are you looking for in general?
Yeah, it's a very complex matchup because it is one of those that goes very long. Both players usually go to fatigue, and you do play every card in your deck. And because you play every card in your deck, the small differences in deck lists are really what tend to make one player favorite over another. I think that the two heal bots really will win this for Bill, and I feel like both players did play it relatively well.
Yeah, and so if you talk to me a little bit about that double heal bot, because that's an inclusion that a lot of Freeze mages don't play, and it really did make a big difference in the matchup. So talk about that inclusion for me.
Yeah, the heal bots are extremely powerful against aggressive strategies, because on turn 5 and maybe even turn 6, you might get to heal bot first and save your AoE effect for later use. Another extremely important matchup for that is that if your opponent is playing something like an aggressive shaman strategy, where there's a lot of damage going at your face, but it's a limited damage, so those cards can help in particular matchups. In other matchups, it might be a weakness.
All right, well, let's take a look at the last clip that we're going to analyze here. This one was from game number 5, actually. And so we're going to set up the play here. It was Bill on the Druid, and Chesty was on the Freeze Mage. Bill probably feels like he's behind just because the nature of this deck. And Bill goes ahead and makes a very bold play here, so we can go ahead and roll it. And Reynad, I know that you happen to just be an expert on this play, as we're going to see it play out. So why don't you guide us through it?
This is the play of champions, TJ, is what this is. You muster some courage. You play your Ancient of War in the correct mode, and you hope for the best. It's a play that's important when you're behind. I mean, it just gives you the opportunity to deal a ton of damage out of nowhere, and it really is kind of a Hail Mary play from Bill in a rough matchup, so I can't fault him for doing this.
Yeah, in general, this is a good matchup for Druid against Freeze Mage, but the type of Druid that Bill was playing, he has to take some chances to be able to win, and with that one Blizzard gone already, the most likely AoE to be following that turn was the Flamestrike, and if there was a Flamestrike, the 10-1 would have survived, and that would have been 10 damage to face.
Yeah, and that ends up being, you know, a difference in the long run, perhaps, getting that 10 damage in, if he could. He realized he was behind, so he had to make a risky play. And sometimes that's what you need to do. But that was our last match of the day. We are going to get a full day breakdown in just a moment. But before we do that, check out some highlights from the last match. Welcome back, everybody. Yeah, you just saw some of the highlights from Chess Dude's win there. Again, he'll play tomorrow. But let's take a look at the bigger picture here. Let's go over and get a recap on the day. We'll start with game number one that we saw today, or match number one. It was between Nostum and Amnesiac. And Amnesiac brought a bold lineup to this tournament. It paid off yesterday, but not so much today. Raynad, what do you think? What do you make of Amnesiac's lineup with Rogue and Murloc Paladin?
I mean, definitely some bold classes to bring to a tournament, and he did play them very well. But yeah, Nostum had a good ban strategy, getting rid of that Murloc, and played pretty well to take the series convincingly.
Yeah, after seeing both of those players, Savitz, do you think Amnesiac has a chance to advance in the group with Nostum later on tomorrow?
He definitely has a good chance to survive. I personally am a huge fan of the lineup that Amnesiac brought. Against Nostum, it wasn't that strong, but I think the Murloc Paladin is a good call in general to be bringing into this tournament.
Yeah, definitely. And we can actually head into match number two here, talk a little bit about that one. We went to the next winner's matchup for the second one of the day. That was Snail versus Sky High. And these were two probably of the most unknown players so far. And Snail really struggled to find a win with Patron War. He queued it up all three times, and all three times were losses. So Raynad, why do you think he struggled so much with this Patron War? Is it just that the deck is weakened right now in the format?
The deck is strong, but it is very difficult to play. He definitely had the opportunity to win a couple of the games with better lines of play, but you know, the nerves can get to you. It is a big stage, and this is really where LAN experience can help out.
And Al Sky High being one of the only players, Savitz, to bring the Secret Paladin deck, or you know, Egg Secret Paladin for him. Were you expecting more coming into the tournament? And now that we've seen some of the successes and failures that it had, were you expecting more?
I think that deck can work out just fine, and it's a fine choice. He did beat Snail with it, but that series maybe kind of came down to more about Snail struggling to find anything going or to get anything going with that Warrior deck in particular.
Yeah, and of course that was a winner's match. So both of those players we will see tomorrow. Snail will play in the decider match against Chess Dude, and of course Sky High moving on to the round of four. So we're going to take a look at the third match that we saw today. It was between Talion and Chalky, and Chalky went up to a quick 2-0 lead in the series, but struggled to find a win with his Shaman. Raynad, you had a few criticisms for some of the inclusions. Why did he struggle so much with the Shaman?
Well, because he didn't use a list from Tempestorm.com. That's my guess, TJ. I really feel like if he went for the more traditional type of list with Unbound Elemental, Overload cards, Lava Shock, like the deck might have performed a bit better.
Yeah, and Savitz, again, going back to the aggro Shaman, it's one of the decks that, after talking to a lot of players over the past couple of days, they say it's one of the strongest in the current format. Did he just have poor draws today, or do you two think that maybe he needs to go back to the drawing board with the deck?
Well, personally, the type of aggro shaman that Chalky was running, it's not my favorite version. But knowing Chalky, I'm sure that he figured out. He has practiced this extensively and figured out this is the best he can do. But I don't know, like the lack of ancestral knowledge, for example. I'm not saying it's bad, but it's certainly questionable if that card is not included.
Yeah, and Chalky, of course, a player that does analyze a lot of his matches. He was eliminated, so we'll probably see him back in spring. We'll have to see how he's going to do there. But that's going to do it from the analyst desk. Thank you guys so much for your expert insight throughout the day and throughout the weekend. And we are going to send it back over to the caster desk to close out the day.
Appreciate it, TJ and crew. What a great job to wrap up the day. And we just want to check in one more time with you guys and remind you about what's happened and also what's going to happen tomorrow. Day three, we're going to crown an America's champion. Person will get $25,000 and a chance to go to the World Championship secured spot directly. Right now, we have four players who are guaranteed to go to the top four, but we have a couple decider matches tomorrow, don't we, Tuttle?
We do indeed. As you see, the Group A lower decider here between Amnesiac and Talion will take place. Both of these players down their last chance.
And over in Group B, we also had an opportunity to see WTY Bill and Chestu go at it. Chestu will play against Snail in Group B. That's going to be an exciting match just for the stories, I think, on both sides, Cora.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be a really great day. We've got some underdogs coming through. We're going to see Amnesiac play again. Nostum actually already through to the round of four. So some more established players and then some less established players coming in. So it's going to be really exciting to see just who comes out on top.
Absolutely. And with that, let's take a look at tomorrow's schedule. We'll have the matches to decide the groups for second place, Amnesiac versus Talion, followed by Snail versus Chess2. Then we get to the main course, the semifinals and the grand finals. As you can see, it's going to be all here on twitch.tv/playHearthstone. We do want to remind people also that we're going into daylight savings time. Our stream will be starting at 10 a.m. Pacific, the same time, but it'll be 1 hour quicker. Also, we'll be revealing another card tomorrow from Whispers of the Old Gods expansion, so be sure to tune in right here on this channel. From Frodan, Sado, Koro, and everyone here in Hollywood, California, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you guys tomorrow.